Welcome to this Mayor and City Council meeting for Monday, March 18th at 6 p.m. First order of business, a prayer and a pledge. Would you all stand? And the pledge and prayers can be given by Kelly, our city clerk.
Father in heaven, we call upon your presence today to guide us in every thought, word, and deed. Infuse a measure of goodwill and great spirit. In your name we pray. Amen.
Mr. Mayor, would you lead us in the pledge?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Kelly. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Next on the agenda is approval of minutes for work session dated February 26, 2013, and regular session number 4 dated March 4, 2013. We'll consider them approved. There's no additions, deletions, or corrections. All right. Okay. Moving on. Next on the agenda is comments from the public. Any person who may wish to speak on any matter at the regular session may be heard during comments for the public for a period of 3 minutes or such time as may be deemed appropriate by the council president. Anyone wishing to be heard shall state their name and address and the subject on which he or she wishes to speak. Yes, sir, in the back. Come on up.
Hello, I'm Randy Davis, Warmby Ranch. How you doing, guys?
Good.
I've had a lot of, lots and lots of people has asked me about summertime carriage rides, so that's what I'm here to talk about. I've come up with a different route and a different time, hours, and such. I don't know what the next step is to try to do this. That's why I'm here to talk to you guys, see what your opinions are and see what everybody likes about it or don't like. I've actually wrote down the little route here on some papers. So maybe if you guys would like to have one, just tell them for everybody if they'd like to have that. I've had everybody, I'd say probably 98% of people to get in my carriage in the winter time here, ask me about the summertime rides. And I've looked long and hard to find this route that I think would be safely that I could do it and at nighttime when there wouldn't be so much traffic, I would hope. Of course, at nighttime, I have all my lights on and all that such stuff as well. I follow all the laws, as you guys know, all the stuff that I already do, because I have been doing it all winter. I don't know what the next step would be to try to accomplish this thing.
Randy, it sounds like a great endeavor. Basically, I'd like to maybe schedule in for work sessions when we have more time and we have the staff here to look at this.
Sounds great.
We actually forward this to the staff and then have their recommendations and for them to come back to us.
Sure. Sounds great.
Would that be okay? It. Okay with the council?
Oh, it's great.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you. All right. Yep. Good to see you again.
Right. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Yep. Anyone else? Yes, sir.
I do have I just want to comment.
Sorry. Randy?
Not comment to Randy, but when, because, you know, season's coming, so I'm hoping that Randy gets on the agenda soon.
Yeah, because I end April the 14th on the boardwalk, of course, and the new route is not the boardwalk because I couldn't compete with all that. That'd be almost impossible. I'm hoping to get it done before the 14th would be nice.
Well, we'll see what we can do to schedule in as soon as
okay.
we can. Thank you.
Good luck.
Thank you. Thank you, Margaret. Okay. Anyone else? Yes, sir. State your name and address for the record, please.
Al Pop Lanning, 100 Somerset Street, Ocean City, Maryland. Tonight, I'd just like to hit upon my subject is to reduce bars and control. I'm requesting on behalf of the greater good of this our fine city, Ocean City, Maryland, that a proposal, plan, and required posting of bylaws governing responsible consumption of alcohol be presented to, for, and by the mayor and city council, and for all the bars and restaurants to post such bylaws for the benefit of all patrons, businesses, and overall prosperity of all who visit and live here in Ocean City. This would be the to mayor and city council, a posting that the city is supporting and requiring the bars and restaurants to require all patrons to post and to abide by such basic behavioral bylaws. which will assist in providing such good experience for all its customers, which will also help each establishment to avert possible, probable, and potential hazards of adding people and alcohol together. As we know, Ethel is no lady. You learned this in high school. This is a present reality that the mayor and city council must and should spearhead in order to promote a safe and cleaner environment. Please help Ocean City move towards a safe family and vacation place to live. Thank you. Leslie.
Thank you. Thank you, McMillan. All right. Anybody else in the audience? Yes, sir.
Whew. That was me. I have a text, Mr.
How are you?
John Atkins, 8802 Caribbean Drive, Ocean City. I'd like to speak on where we have the citizens' comments at the beginning of the meeting. To me, it reminds me of having a book report in high school and not being able to read the book. Because in order to comment, I've got to hear what you all have to say or what your decisions are. You know, and at the beginning of the meeting, I don't know what you're going to talk about, what you're going to argue about, what you're going to discuss, even though it's on the agenda, but things change. I would like to see the minutes move to the end of the meeting. Also, when you have a budget hearing, and we're coming up on that, I'd still like to see comments by the public at the end of the budget meeting. If they have an idea that one staff hasn't remembered or forgot about or wasn't their idea, at least the public at the end of it, when they hear all the different meetings, and I've been to them for a couple years, I still go to the work sessions, but there is things that can change, and the only way to know that is after the meeting is at the end and you've all made your comments, not at the beginning. So that's, Frank, I want you to change that.
We'll look into it. Thank you, Frank. It makes sense. Okay. Anybody else? Yes, sir.
Tony Crist, 403 Bayshore Drive, Bay Vista, number 18. Last time, Mr. Mayor, I asked you if you knew or anyone on the council knew what the obligations, the present obligations of the city were. Mm-hmm. And you deferred the question to Mr. Recor and mm-hmm. moved on. That's a big thing. It's not an easy thing to figure.
That's right.
But oftentimes in life, if you don't have the right information, it affects your decision. Or said differently, if you get one little bit more information, all of a sudden your decision's reversed. Oftentimes, if you think about it in life. And so I want to narrow that and ask another question and hope that the council might be able to address this, because I don't think it's that difficult. Are taxes lower now than they were in 1980? And I've got a suggestion of how to approach it. Find some businesses in 1980 that were here. There are quite a few of them. Find out what they paid. Add 33 years of inflation to it. Index is right there. And compare it with what they're paying today. The problem is with taxes, oftentimes, you see the moving part, the rate, and the assessment, but you don't consider the market value. And they're relevant to the market value. And I'm just asking that question because I think I would like to know, and I think you guys making decisions should know the answer. Are taxes higher now than they were in 1980? So again, just by looking at that, that's a much easier thing to determine. And it's not because I'd like to know it. It's just I think it would be good. One fact that the council may have an impression on and may find out a different answer. And I don't know the answer right now. But I know that way to figure it is very clean because we have a lot of businesses that have been here since 1980. And
All right. Thank you, Tony. All right. Anybody else? Yes, sir.
Francis Oaks, I'm from Salisbury, Maryland. Well,
gotta wait till you get up here.
Go on up.
Don't look at them yet. I'll tell you when to look at them. I have a sense of humor,
and I hope that comes across. There's a couple other things I want to come across. One is not that I think good humor is great ice cream, but I do want to talk about ice cream. So,
I didn't get one.
Here I go.
Everybody get one?
In my 3 minutes, I need you to know that I'm smart, I'm kind of wholesome, and I have...
Get his name and address again.
Francis Hooks, 616 Camden Avenue, Salisbury, Maryland. It is about 9A, the opening of the bids. I want you to consider not opening, or if you do open, to look at these bids, are they adequate? And I can convince you that I'm smart by telling you about what I know about ice cream and the importance of a small crystal and holding the temperature very, very low when it's formed. And if you let it go up and down, we call that freezer burn, and it tastes bad. And Good Humor and the other vendors lately don't follow that thinking. They just try to make kids happy. I want to make grown-ups happy in Ocean City this summer, and I want to go with high-end, high cream, so a little bit of high cost, and well-frozen ice cream. But to do that, it takes more than 7 to 10 days to get the business together. And that's all I've had. Not your fault. Fault of the New York guys waiting to tell you they weren't coming back. Fault of the media for not getting the story straight about what the status is of the bidder or bidders to be. So what I'm worried you're getting tonight, if you open these bids, one is not mine, is low, and it's not good enough. The attempt to make Ocean City more like the Ocean City of yesteryear, what Lewis has kind of done, will not be served by taking a low bidder that's just looking at kid stuff. So far, I don't sound smart to myself, but let me get back to it. I came here in 1981 from Salisbury, and I worked for Layton's that summer and Chippity Doodah up on the boardwalk, which was next to Dayton's then. Now it's Dough Roller. The next summer, I was at Phillips for a summer in the carryout, worked with Jeanette Grice and Joe Rudney, and then back to Layton's for a summer, and then four in a row with Phillips while I was getting my degree in biology, minor in chemistry, then off to Baltimore, worked at Hopkins as a lab tech, and you know that hospital's reputation for smart folks and doing good things. And then I was back in Ocean City with Shenanigans for a summer or two. Then I worked for Town of Ocean City Lab Services, so I helped make sure the water was clean enough to drink and wastewater clean enough to put back in the ocean. So that's wholesomeness on my heart, and smart again. So smart, wholesome, and I know quality and good taste is what I'm wanting you to know about me. So go ahead now and reveal what I've given you and look at it. You'll see that's Terry Layton and I way back in the day, 31 years ago. If I'd been on Buxy's White Marlin boat when he won, I wouldn't be in front of you tonight for this. I'd have a good bid in already. But those are the folks I want you to think of, because you don't know me, but you do know Terry Layton. You do know Buxy. You do know Greg. In fact, I'd rather you think of Greg's brother, the judge, when you think of me. And Jeanette Grice and the great Bryce Phillips and those people I've worked for. When I ask you, give me some more time. Either don't open the bids tonight, or if you do, look at them thinking, we may be able to do better. And again, it's not your fault. It's the fault of not getting the word out yet to people like me who know ice cream better than, or know good enough to know that Good Humor might not be good enough. So I know I'm over 3 minutes, but thanks for the time.
Thank you.
Remember, smart, wholesome, and knows good taste.
Margaret, you got a question?
Yeah, I just wanted to ask somebody, because I have been out of town. I was on vacation. I'm sorry. But did we give enough time to the public to be able to, did we give the legal amount of time for them to be able to get this information as the gentleman's talking?
Yes,
some
ma'am.
Some stuff didn't get in the paper, and there was some confusion.
No, it was placed in the paper. It was posted in the paper, and I believe it was posted for 2 weeks. It was in the Ocean City Digest, and, you know, those who may not.
I may not understand then your, sir, if you'll come back up so you can talk to the record.
You got to wait till you get here.
Yeah. Is that it appeared in the right places, but not at the time when the right people were looking in those places.
Oh.
Got it.
Yeah.
And now that I've made the big fuss, I don't think anyone will say, oh, we didn't know at this point. But
We do have a legal responsibility, though, to answer it in a timely manner, and we got bids. So, sorry.
All right. Anybody else in the audience like to speak? Yes, ma'am. Come on up.
Ellie Diggleman, 120th Street, Ocean City, Maryland. the first things I have to cover are all agenda items, so I'm going to try and go through those really quick. Agenda item number 5, standing committee reports. There's no committee reports. I remember back when you guys used to have the committees that there was always a report, like Rec and Parks or whatever.
That was an oversight by...
Okay.
But they are being posted on the website as we speak. Well, they'll be on the website first thing tomorrow.
Are they going to be in the agendas from now on? The agenda packets?
They'll all be in the agendas from now on, yes, like they used to be. Yeah.
Okay, good. The number 6A, the due tour for June 20th to the 23rd, the summary page with the cost to the town is missing. And for that, and I looked through the rest of the packet, it's pages 9 to 24, and I could not find anything about what it will or won't cost the town, either in in-kind services or otherwise.
Well, last year's costs are in there, and they are on, I'm trying to think what page.
97.
Yeah, I saw that.
Okay, and that's, we don't know what this year's costs are until they happen.
Okay, and I was going to ask you to...
Go ahead.
I'm sorry, I was going to ask you to postpone it until all the facts are in, but I guess if basing it on last year's costs would suffice, then...
That what happens is they pay for whatever it costs.
Okay.
They pay us the actual cost of what it cost us to do the business.
Because when we get into these major events, it makes me scared to approve anything.
Did you read the draft MOU?
Pardon?
Did you read the draft MOU?
I did not. I skimmed through everything, and I did see the last year's costs. Yeah, but I just get really nervous when it comes to these high dollars that, you know.
Right, the draft MOU has all the what they're supposed to do and how it's going to go as far as that goes. They're going to pay for the cost. Brent?
I have a quick question. How come we just, speaking of the MOUs, how come we discuss some out front and some in the back?
Some out front.
Why are some of the MOUs out front?
He's asking why we discuss some MOUs in closed session and some out front. I'm sure that Mr. Harris can answer that for you.
Yep.
I think this was already discussed in closed session.
It was.
I don't remember. But
I believe you were absent, possibly absent that day, Mr. Ashley.
Okay, Mr. Matressi, could I get a quick
guy?
Well, it depends on what's going to be, if it's negotiated or not.
Yeah.
Many of these aren't negotiated, so they're just a flat-out MOU that's in the package. But other ones, we have to negotiate costs and who's going to do what. And those negotiations are contract discussions that you all vote to go in closed session on.
Of course, I've been after two.
No, it was before.
Okay, so we're not negotiating on this, but on some of the other ones we were. Is that what the answer is? For example, like TAB and the Ocean City Experience, Bike Week. I mean, I'm just trying to get the difference between
those were negotiated because on certain things they pay for and certain things they don't.
Well, what's the difference between that and a due tour? I mean, they're paying for certain things and we're paying for certain things. So I mean, what's the
This MOU from the due tour was made up based on exactly what they did last year. So there hasn't been any discussions other than between, I'm sure, John Sullivan on behalf of the Rec Department and representatives from the due tour.
But the town is not providing, if I may, Mr. President, the town is not providing funding to the due tour. The due tour is not requesting funding. Direct funding, let me clarify. Certainly we are providing a level of in-kind service to support the due tour, but unlike other private events, the town is not providing a direct funding that is negotiated typically behind closed doors. And if you think most recently, think about the air show, for example, where the there is some funding associated with that in addition to the indirect cost of in-kind support services.
Well, just I guess it just seems to me when you're spending the taxpayers' money, it should all be out in the open. So, okay.
All right. Go ahead, Ellie. We cut in here 3 minutes. Go ahead.
Okay. On number 9A, I'm glad that other gentleman mentioned that vehicle vending franchise was ice cream, because I read through that packet information and could not find what that was all about. So I was just wondering if we can be clearer, more specific from now on in all the agenda items of what they're relevant to. 9B, boardwalk information cottage. I'm kind of confused as to why we're paying the Downtown Association either $3,000 last year or $3,500 this year, plus the plus the utilities and other overhead costs. Number 10, city solicitor items. 10A is the second review of the budget amendment number 1. I know it's a lot too much to go into right this minute, but I'm kind of confused. I did see something about 45 cents per $100 of assessed value or something. So I'm wondering, is that amendment number 1 to the 2013 budget a tax increase, or exactly how much of dollar-wise we're talking about? 10B, the miniature golf as a conditional use downtown, that's a second reading also, and I still think that miniature golf is a pretty lively activity to merge in with mixed-use buildings and such. The 10D, the first reading to amend the pension committee members. On the one hand, it says to amend the pension committee members, and then in parentheses, it talks about changing the trustees to include the mayor and council president. So maybe I'm just not knowledgeable enough about technical stuff like that, but that was kind of confusing to me. 10F, vehicle vending franchise debarment hearing. There again, that was the ice cream thing. And then the non-agenda related items. I was wondering, tomorrow, what time is that the budget work session?
We don't have one.
We don't have one. That's been canceled.
Oh, okay. Because I was looking on the Channel 4, and I didn't see anything.
Right. It's been canceled.
About any of it. Oh. Okay. Is there some way to find out from now on if a meeting gets canceled that...
Then it's not on the website.
Yeah.
Well,
obviously.
Still, it should be noted.
Yeah. I mean, I took off work to be able to go to it, and now that's the day I could have worked.
Right.
So the second item that I had that's non-agenda related is I understand that there's a no-fault budget deficit already of approximately $1.5 million, not including the union contract revisions or other rumored salary increases. Numerous other unaffordable taxes, fees, and increases are also being openly pursued. We, the taxpayers, citizens, visitors, and other consumers, are already sacrificing and suffering cuts in our spending as well as in our property values. As I said, this is not your fault, but nonetheless, the harsh reality does exist, and we can't pretend that it doesn't. You can't squeeze blood out of a turnip. So what budgetary cuts or other adjustments are being considered instead of new taxes and fees or higher taxes and fees? The third item I have is we, the taxpayers, are footing the bill for the hefty union salaries, pensions, and other benefits. When do we get to find out what's in these union contracts that are supposed to be getting ratified right now? Do we find out after they're already ratified? And then the fourth thing is sort of like Nancy Pelosi's deal.
Yeah.
The fourth and final thing is, why are we, the taxpayers, being forced to pay excessive compensation packages to future employees, whether they're union or non-union? Regardless of any campaign promises, you have a fiduciary responsibility to the stewardship of our money, assets, and resources, which does not include deficits and indebtedness. I implore you, no more taxes, no more fees, and no more borrowing.
Thank you. Ms. Dingelman, I just have one request. It's been probably three meetings in a row, and I typically don't speak at this time because it's your time. But three meetings in a row, you've made the allegations of campaign promises. I would hope in the future, if you make that allegation, you can give some examples, names, what the promises were, okay, et cetera, because then I would feel much better about it, because I was one of those people running for office along with a whole lot of other people. There were nine folks running. Mr. Atkins is sitting out there. So I just think when you make allegations, I think to the taxpayer and to me as an elected representative, I need to know the facts. So I would just appreciate that.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you.
All right. Mr. Mayor.
I have the answers to a number of Ellie's questions, but I'm going to wait until we get to that item on the agenda. Okay. That's okay. What it's for.
Yeah. Okay. Margaret?
No, I was doing the same thing.
Okay.
I didn't know when you want to stop.
Okay. All right. Very good. All right. Next on the agenda is items presented by the Mayor and City Council. The first is a standing committee report. Councilmember Matresik,
yes.
Parks and Rec.
I'm happy to report that we had the first Recreation and Parks Committee meeting on March 12th, 2013. Councilmember Dare, City Manager Recor, Susan Petito, and Tom Schuster were in attendance. I was elected chairman. We discussed the surfing beach subcommittee that the mayor has appointed, and we sent out email notices to the appointees and asking them if they could attend a tentative meeting for Monday, April 1st at 4 p.m. in the community room in the city hall. We also set the meeting schedule up, and the meeting will be in the afternoon after our first work session of the month. That way the minutes can go out and we can be on the second Monday night meeting, regular meeting, and so everything is timely. There was an update on the department and highlights from the department's budget request for 2013-2014. The committee also discussed a proposed expansion of the skate park and its design and funding. Committee also discussed the ownership of the property at 3rd and 4th Street, for those that don't know. Mr. Recor reported that the city manager's office will post committee agendas and items on the town's website, and agenda and supporting documents will be sent to Diana Chavis in the city manager's office for that, and these minutes will, in fact, be on. They slipped through the cracks this past week, but they will be, in fact, on the agenda and on the website for the everyone to read. We were all invited to the Northside Outdoor Exercise and Fitness Area Grand Opening Celebration on Saturday, April 6, 2013. He asked that we show up in our workout clothes and not ties and jackets and slacks. And Tom also reported that the department has received a written proposal from Superfund EcoTours requesting a concession operation boat rental at Northside Park. And he's reviewing the proposal and it's going to bring it back to the Recreation and Parks Committee at the next meeting, and then it will come back to the regular council afterwards. Then the meeting was adjourned.
All right. Thank you, Joe. Councilmember Pillows.
Yes, on item about the skate park.
Mm-hmm.
So we already have a design, correct?
Absolutely.
And that's the design you're going to review that design again?
To be honest with you, it was kind of just brought up when we were talking about a possible shade area that they might want to put down around the skate park area where we have no shade. And Mr. Dare brought up where we were in fact with the new design and it's still hanging there on the wall and certainly something that possibly. Hopefully the council would be interested in moving forward in the future if we can secure a lease for the property, and as you know, the county owns that property.
Right. And then the other question is the boat rental. What was some of the particulars about that you did hear?
There was really no particulars about it. It was just Tom had just received the letter, and they the gentleman who does it is the one that we pay to run the park, not the park, the camp up there at Northside Park. And he is interested in setting up there. But there was some question about, Tom had to look into logistics, and there was some questions about possible buildings and electric and everything else that Tom had to kind of to meet with the gentleman and fed
also out. When they go out for bid.
Yeah, and that was another discussion that we did have that, you know, if before we move forward with anything like that, it would have come back to the council. We decide which way we wanted to go.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Councilmember Tresick. Next is the Tourism Commission, Council Secretary Knight.
Yes, we met last Friday at 3 p.m., so I apologize. We don't have minutes to hand out. But again, they will be on the web page tomorrow. It was a very good meeting, and all of our partners were represented. Besides myself, I was elected chairperson. Dennis Stair was there, the mayor was there, and council member Matresic. But our partners, we had a representative from the Economic Development Committee, the OCDC, the HMRA, the Chamber of Commerce, the State of Maryland. We also entertained the executive directors of the HMRA and the Chamber. The press was present. We're doing something a little different this month because with the meeting being on Friday, we have some issues that need to be taken care of tonight. Typically, I would report what happened and then we would have a work session to take action. But because we're dealing with advertising and media buys, we're doing it a little differently, and that's why we invited Andy Malice, who is president of MGH. We didn't think it would be fair for myself to report on the actions or the decisions that were made and why they were made. We wanted Mr. Malice to be here. But to summarize what we're looking at, and he'll come up in a minute, we're looking at a campaign, a print ad campaign to help. Right now there's a bill in front of the Maryland State Legislature to start school after Labor Day. So we would be hoping this campaign after the session would end, we might initialize this campaign. We're also looking at some of our advertising buys to include New York and New Jersey, expanding to the Pittsburgh area. We're announcing what our summer campaign would be, and we're also announcing some changes in our social media. So with that, we'd like to bring Andy up, who can do a much better job of it than I can. Andy and Donna, I'm sorry. Our tourism director was also there, Donna. She's everywhere, so I just assumed you all knew that.
Thank you, Mary. I just wanted to preface and add to your remarks that we will have the minutes posted tomorrow. That time factor was really squeezed, but we have to do these, well, we hope we can do these media buys if all the council agrees with this plan. And then from here on out, the meetings will be held on the second Thursday of the month at 1 o'clock at the convention
center in room 214.
Right. And with the first part component that Andy is going to present today, the Tourism Commission recommended support of it and to bring it forward to the full council for review. We'd like to hold off on enacting it until after the legislative session if we can. We think it's fun, it's a good idea, but it's also maybe needs to sit there a little bit and wait until the timing is better for that campaign. But we do want to share it with you tonight.
Great, thank you.
Thank you, good seeing everybody. I'm gonna just give you a cut down version of the presentation that we made on Friday, and also have made a number of adjustments to what we presented based on the input that we had. But first, everybody's been talking about, over the years, we've been able to do some pretty unusual campaigns from time to time to get extraordinary amount of attention. Some of you may remember our cicada-free zone campaign that we did. These are all very short-term campaigns that got national attention. And then a few years ago, the one about the ocean was evaporating. The mayor was even on Fox News Channel nationally for it. When I heard about the possibility that that there was a movement in the state to make schools start after Labor Day again, I was really excited about it. Because when I was growing up, as I'm sure a lot of people in the room, the idea of going to school before Labor Day was insane to say, I mean, we wouldn't stand for it. And right now, as has been mentioned, there is several bills in the legislature, one that Senator Mathias has put forth to just have a task force to study the idea. And I thought this was being handed to us as a great opportunity to do one of those campaigns. So we came up with this print ad, and we're talking to various people about the timing that we should do. But of course, the print ad is really just a stepping stone or a platform to get publicity for it, so that we would get interviews and things like that. Mm-hmm. And the idea of it, and I'm going to read it to you because I know you can't, the idea of it is to start a petition drive to get people to sign up to show support for school after Labor Day. And I'm going to read it to you right now very quickly, but it's obviously supposed to be funny, so I'm hoping that there'll be some laughter in the audience. The headline says, Children of Maryland Unite, beg your parents to sign our petition to start school after Labor Day. Copy starts, Hello, children. This is Ocean City, Maryland. We realize the newspaper isn't the ideal medium to reach those in the 0 to 18 set, but we're hoping that perhaps your parents have left the paper on your kitchen table, unknowingly turned to this page. If so, please read on, for there's something you need to be aware of, something important. And then the little subhead says, The government is stealing your fun. In the state where we live, it's Maryland, in case you haven't yet gotten to that in social studies, school systems have been systematically shortening your summer vacation. In some cases, school now begins on August 20th, more than a full month before the actual end of summer. That's just wrong. What those in power don't want you to know is it hasn't always been this way. In fact, when your parents were growing up, school didn't start until after Labor Day. That's right, your parents and their parents before them spent the final days of August not in a possibly unair-conditioned schoolroom, but out in the fresh air of Ocean City, Maryland. They packed into the boardwalk tram, not a school bus. They enjoyed one last gulp of freedom before putting their noses to the grindstone that is school. Next subhead says, Dangers of skee-ball deprivation. We don't yet know the long-term effects of being denied this extra bit of fun. What we do know is a few more games of skee ball could have finally earned you enough tickets for that lava lamp you've had your eyes on.
I like that.
But that chance has been snatched away from you by well-meaning bureaucrats who have forgotten the value of fun in a child's life. Think about it. A generation will now grow up without the time to fully master the boogie board. Next headline says, Don't deflate your wrath, there's hope. A recent survey of grown-ups with kids in Maryland schools revealed that 79% support starting school after Labor Day. And right now, a bill is being considered in the Maryland Senate that would study the issue. Meantime, Virginia, among other states, has already adopted an after Labor Day school start. That means kids who live just a short drive away will be getting way more saltwater taffy than you this summer. Not fair. Why? I'm not a good actor, but that's what it says. Then it says, do what you do best, nag your parents. We've started an online petition to show Maryland's legislators just how much support there is for starting school after Labor Day. Tell your parents to sign it at longersummer.com. We aren't suggesting fewer school days, just a reexamination of the school calendar. Because while it might just seem like a week or two lost every year, it adds up to an entire summer lost over the course of your childhood. And that's a summer you'll never get back unless we fight. And then there's a little picture of the mayor down there, and it says, it identifies him as fun expert and OC Mayor Rick Meehan. Quote, we believe test scores are important, but let's not forget mini golf scores. Restore summer vacation. Sign our petition at longersummer.com. So, and then if you go to that, there'll be a very quick web page where it says sign the petition. We'll be collecting the names and addresses and the emails, which we'll be able to add to our database. There's a place there to click to share this on Facebook. So the thousands or millions of people, the tens of thousands of people that will sign this will then share this on their Facebook, which will be seen by all their people. And it basically just says, yes, I want kids to enjoy a little more time at the beach just like I did, or no, I hate fun and want to pass that on to my children. So anyway, it's just a fun campaign, and we're sort of kicking around whether to do or not.
Councilmember Ashley.
Well, Annie, just a question after hearing that. Has there been any thought or conversations to the fact that you're basically using advertising money for a political purpose? Or, I mean, I can see where that might not sit too well with some people that may not be for this.
That's bigger than my pay grade, I think, to decide. We were looking at it as obviously just a way to create attention for Ocean City.
I understand, but
you make a point that, you know.
Seems to me I take it as political. So
I don't think the advertising money is for political purposes. So
we did, by the way, the survey that we actually did, a survey that was by Public Opinion Research. It was a real survey, and that 79% is kind of an overwhelming, you know, number of Marylanders that are in support of this, those with school-age children. So,
but people voting on that may not agree with that.
Ask the legal question of Guy. Guy, is that the use of the funds? Can we use it for this purpose?
I don't think that type of satire falls into the political arena, but right. I mean, somebody, I guess, could make that argument, but I wouldn't be concerned about it.
That's how I took it, so.
Well, okay. I just think that, it, you know, you're pushing for another week in Ocean City, so I push it, I think of it that way, and I understand what you're saying, Brent, but I do think that one more week in Ocean City would better everybody. Jeez, you know, I'm still in business, so. well, Councilmember Knight.
I just hope that the legislators you're trying to convince take it that way.
Right, I agree. Councilmember Knight.
Oh, all I was going to say is that, number one, we're not looking for a vote on this tonight. We wanted to present it. And number two, everybody in the room was very, very excited because, as you said, Council President, they're looking at, this is another way. It's a whole week. It's that last week in August, that which is very, very dead for us. So that's how it was, you know, the economic impact, plus, you know, all the press we would get. But that's a good point, and we will discuss it. So this is one action that we can put off. The other ones we do have to mentioned tonight.
Yeah. I mean, I personally can't think of anything that would help Ocean City more than getting schools to start after right. Labor Day again.
So. Right.
I should mention Councilmember Ashley, we have calls into the Director of Tourism for the state of Maryland. We have made calls to make sure, you know, that they agreed with it. And
we're working on that.
But no, it's a good point, and we'll make sure.
You're not going on the record being anti-fun, are you, Brent? I want to make sure.
No, Andy, I'm okay, not. Good. I'm a fun guy.
I want to make sure.
Everybody can tell you that. Yeah.
We got laughter out of the audience on that one.
That's the biggest laugh so far.
There's the ad. Let me introduce you to a fun guy.
Hey, that's me.
Okay, and now, so that was just really for information. Now we really want to talk about what we want to do this year and what we talked to the Tourism Commission about on Friday. First of all, I think we all need to recognize the fact that after Hurricane Sandy hit, and, you know, thank God, you know, that we were not, you know, affected by it, but obviously we could have been. It has changed the marketplace for what we sell. And, you know, my job is to look at, you know, selling Ocean City, the product that we have. And it would be irresponsible for us not to look at it in those terms. And again, not, you know, believe me, nobody, we would all be much happier to, you know, if this had never occurred to our neighbors to the north. But it did. And it is affecting the marketplace. And so I have a responsibility to bring that information to your attention. We did an extremely thorough research into every single town in New Jersey and up to New York, and we presented that. I'm only going to give you a couple slides today to the Tourism Commission the other day to really show what's really happening, because there's a difference between the press and the PR and what the state of New Jersey is saying and what's really happening on the ground. And the truth is that it's rough. And it's not going to be, they're not going to be competing as they normally do in some regards. Just released less than a month ago, Rutgers University did a poll, and the poll showed that only 64% of those who identify themselves as regular Jersey Shore visitors plan to spend as much time at the shore this summer compared to past summers. That is a pretty low number. I mean, if we were to poll regular Ocean City people come every year, it would be close to 100% that they come year after year. 30% of the visitors who stay 4 days to a week regularly are planning to cut back. And 63% of those who plan to spend less time or no time at all cited Hurricane Sandy. There are less restaurants open. There's less amusement parks open. There is less inventory of hotel rooms and condominiums that are going to be available. And that is all affecting the Jersey Shore. We presented a lot of quotes the other day, but clearly they're worried. They're worried because they feel like if they lose some people and they are attracted to other things, then people may change their habits. And this is no different from in the 10 or 11 years that I've been working with you, how cruises all of a sudden became popular in the summer. That wasn't true 10 years ago. People never went to the Caribbean 10 years ago in the summer. The internet has changed people's habits. So people that regularly came here now sometimes do other things. So this is a market threat to them, as we have all been dealing with the changes in vacations and what we've had to deal with. So basically, visitors who previously vacationed at the shore are looking for alternatives. They're also putting off their bookings. They're waiting to see. They're close enough they can check out to see how things are going before they decide if they're going to vacation there or not. But let's keep in mind that New Jersey is not playing dead here. They're fighting back. The lieutenant governor was quoted, that they are not, they're not going to give up on this. And they're trying to get an additional $20 million put towards marketing for this summer. And they're still working on that up in New Jersey. So more than any other year, the strength, timing, and geography of our marketing is critical. And we should keep what's happening up north in mind. This event has given us an unprecedented opportunity to reach people who didn't hear us before. You know, we have advertised heavily for 5 years now in New Jersey, New York, Philadelphia. You all can see by the number of cars on the road in the summer that we've reached those people and they're becoming regular visitors. But a big chunk of those people never heard our advertising message. They had no interest whatsoever in changing their habit of where they would regularly go. This year, they may hear us. They may not hear us again in a year. And so it's important that we are heard. Without taking advantage by doing any particular marketing messages that would look like we're trying to take advantage of the situation. I said to the Tourism Commission on Friday, and I'll repeat it today, in spite of what you may think about people in my profession, we do have ethics. And, I would not, for example, personally advertise tobacco. I would not advertise furs. I'm just not, and I certainly would not want to take advantage by doing something particularly different. But there's no reason why we can't continue to do what we've been doing and make sure that our message gets heard. Do you want me to pause?
Ashley, yeah, got a question.
Let me just throw my two cents in for a second here. I ran into Greg Shockley a couple weeks ago over at one of the stores here. Anyway, my idea was encourage the people to go back to their Jersey beaches, okay? Do the campaign that we understand what it's like to have natural disasters, and we appreciate what the business people are going through, and we want to encourage people to go back to their Jersey beaches if possible. I think that type of campaign would create so much goodwill, it would be priceless. Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah. Take the tack, go back. Mm-hmm. But, of course, if they can't, then they'll be thinking of us. But just the goodwill would be priceless.
Yeah, I would throw that to the Tourism Commission to discuss.
Okay.
So what are we going to do? We're suggesting that we start our media a little bit earlier this year. We want to do a little bit heavier buy in New York, New Jersey, and Philadelphia. And one of the suggestions that came out of the HMRA and chamber meeting that we had at the end of season summary was to add Pittsburgh. Last year, we did a little bit of buys in Pittsburgh, and this year, we want to increase that, and that was recommended by the Tourism Commission on Friday. This is just a quick comparison of last year versus this year. This is the number of weeks that we'll be on television. As you can see, Philadelphia, New Jersey, New York, we're going to go add 4 weeks, which is pretty significant, going from 12 to 16. Stay flat in our closer home markets, 13 in D.C., Hilly, and Baltimore. And now we're going to add Pittsburgh. Pittsburgh is a very efficient market. It's not that expensive, so we're able to do that.
Councilmember Ashley? Good.
Well, as far as Pittsburgh, and I can tell you from being in the motel business for over 30 years, there's a great market in the Pittsburgh area. McKee's Port, McKee's Rock, all in that area, okay? And I also was starting to see people from West Virginia, Eastern Ohio, so.
Right, they'll see the advertising because it'll be in the Pittsburgh market.
Right, it's a wonderful market. Yeah. I think we haven't done that in a while, but.
Right. Well, and the feeling, obviously, of the folks on the commission was they're not going to come for the weekend. That's a long drive.
Correct, and so, as you know, I think that the weekly rentals have dropped off considerably in the last couple of years, and they're the people, the longer they have to come, same with our Canadian visitors, the further they have to come, the longer they're going to stay.
Yeah. So. Thank you, Brent.
So sir. Thank you. This just to give you an idea, you know, we're on all major prime time, you know, all the top shows. We're seen by everyone. In addition, we're going to have online for a full 22 weeks. That's both search and also display advertising. 19 weeks of outdoor ads, and if anybody who drives in the season up and down 95, you see our boards everywhere. And then every year we save a little bit of money for a couple weeks of radio in July to promote the hotel week. And we plan on doing that again this year. Last year we did the Summer of Thanks, which was our hook that was to talk about the deals and all the free things that you get to do here in Ocean City, and the fireworks on the beach were so great, and the light show and the laser show. I mean, just a tremendously successful thing, plus all the other things that we do, plus all the deals and discounts that are offered up by the business community. So this year, we recommended to introduce a little different hook, and we're calling it the Lucky Summer of 13, because it's the Summer of 13. And we're going to promote that using three of our older commercials. Again, in order to get more media out there this year, we're not creating new advertising. We're going to use three of the older, more popular Rodney commercials. One was the one called Suburbs. Another one was the one called City. And then a new one from last year, which was about air travel, which is always timely. It's very easy just to get in the car. You don't have the hassles of air travel. We're changing the end of the spots, where normally it would have, before it would have said, go to Summer of Thanks. Now it's going to say go to OCOcean.com and click on Lucky Summer of 13 for special deals and discounts. On our website, as you can see, there will be a prominent display of the Lucky Summer of 13 discounts, and that says, this is your lucky summer with special deals and discounts. You'll save big on accommodations, dining, entertainment, and more. Click here for all the discounts. That takes you to the Lucky Summer of 13 page, which will have all the discounts from all of our business partners that'll be loaded in there on a regular basis. That's, we don't have to read, but it's just that's basically just reiterating the Summer of 13. Now, one thing we're going to do a little bit different this year is that for about 15% of the commercials that air, instead of the tag that you saw that said go to OCOcean.com, we're going to direct them to our Facebook page. We have great content on our Facebook page. Our Facebook page, has 500,000 fans on it, and we're going to promote a sweepstakes. Again, about 15% of the total end of the commercials will run this, and it'll say go to facebook.com/OceanCity and enter to win big in the Lucky Summer of 13 sweepstakes. We did a sweepstakes last year. Again, we're going to do it this year. This way we get more people to like our page, we get people to enter the contest, we get email addresses, and we'll give away a week's stay here in Ocean City. This is the the Facebook page for Ocean City, and as you can see on the right side, that's where the call out will be for the sweepstakes, so it'll be easy to find. When you click on that, you'll be taken to this page, and in order to enter, you'd have to like the page, which means we get you as a follower. And then you'll share the fact that you've entered the sweepstakes when you go to this page where you fill in your name, address, age, all that information. And of course, there's a check there to opt in to become to get our newsletter, which is what we want everybody to get our newsletter all the time. You'll not only enter, but then you'll click here and you'll see all the prizes. And one of the things we talked about was having one big prize, 12 more. So we'll have 12 minor prizes, so there'll be a lot more winners and more people can share that information. As you know, we're very active in social media, not just in Facebook, but also Twitter, Pinterest, and Tumblr. And this year, we're going to add Instagram. Any of you, I'm sure, have been hearing about Instagram. Instagram is a photo-based social network, and it's all about sharing pictures and editing those pictures and sharing them with your friends. It's grown like crazy. There are 90 million monthly active users. 40 million photos are uploaded a day to Pinterest. 8,500 likes of photos per second, and 1,000 comments per second are posted. So this is a place, again, as we continue to add our social media properties, that we need to be. Interestingly, Instagram has now surpassed Twitter as the second largest social media property over behind Facebook. This is a typical Instagram page. This shows you where people have tag their photos for Ocean City, Maryland, which is that hashtag on the top. And if you do that and you tag your pictures, then people see a running lowdown of all the pictures related to Ocean City, Maryland. We're going to encourage people to do that, and then this will be our Instagram page. Our Instagram page will have both user-submitted pictures that we will vet to make sure nobody places anything that's inappropriate on our page. And it's also going to have a feed of the pictures that people have tagged themselves as being related to Ocean City, Maryland. We're going to find, and we're going to ask our Facebook fans, we're going to ask them, where are the great places to take pictures in Ocean City? You know, is it next to the Ripley's, you know, the big tire shark? Is it, you know, is there a particular beautiful sunset place to take a picture? Wherever. We're going to ask them, where are these great places? And we're going to put these signs over town to encourage people to take a picture, to tag it with OCMD, which is what you do, and then upload it to Instagram. And we will pick every week a winner of the best picture that was taken, and we will send them a Lucky Summer of 13 t-shirt. So everything is integrated. We're promoting Instagram, Facebook, Lucky Summer of 13. It's going to be on the television. It's going to be online. It's going to be everywhere. So again, another fully integrated summer campaign for Ocean City, which we think will be very successful. We're also going to do a thing called Deals of the Week. We're going to ask our business partners to offer up a very special deal, and every week we will pick one of those deals to be promoted on our Facebook page exclusive to our Facebook fans. It would be another reason why people would want to like our Facebook page, they were very enthusiastic about this when we presented on Friday. This is a sample of some of the Facebook advertising that we'll be doing this year to promote Summer of 13, Instagram, and how to win our contest. Every year we try very hard to get all the OC events covered in the press in all the areas that we market. We're going to be doing a special calendar this year for the press, every month there will be all the events promoted to the press so that they can talk about all the events that are happening in Ocean City. Here's a sample, a page for May of this press kit that will go out to all the media, which will be going out shortly. Of course, we go on the road with Mayor Meehan. He is our great spokesman for us and does a great job. And we're going to start in Baltimore with prior to SpringFest. We always do the AAA press conference every year. We're going to do September in Baltimore to promote SunFest in the fall and, of course, WinterFest and New Year's in Baltimore. We also go to D.C. before July 4th, and we'll be in Philadelphia. And every year, the reception for us in Philadelphia is great, and every year the mayor gets in free beaches in Ocean City, which is great, so we don't have to pay for it. We also provide all of these marketing elements for the business. These are the Lucky Summer of 13 logos, the posters, everything that they would need to participate in that. We keep our event sheet up to date. Every month we produce a new event sheet so that all the hotels and properties can pass that out to their guests. Of course, every picture of Rodney you'd ever need for your advertising. And the last point I want to make tonight is our insiders, which we talk about, do such a great job. Every year, the number of questions that are asked of our insiders keeps increasing, over 1,200 this year. This past season, they provided 5,000 answers to 1,200 questions. These are an incredible group of people, and they will be back here in town April 27th and 28th for the annual summit. They'll be trained on a new web interface that we've created for them to make their sharing easier. We're going to train them on the new messages. They're going to, of course, visit new properties, and they're going to hear about our new marketing initiatives. I know I went on for a long time. I thought it was going to be faster. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Andy. Appreciate that very much. A great presentation, and I think the marketing plan is a great idea moving forward, especially in Philadelphia, and I think Councilmember Ashley really agrees with that as well. Councilmember Pillows.
I have a question.
I'll be so sure.
Has Donnie, you've included OC what? Experience in the Lucky 13, right? He's got all that information, so when he goes to different shows, he's able to promote.
The OC Experience has been completed for the year. We just did our last show in Washington last weekend. Okay. We've done 4 shows already.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Councilmember Knight.
I'd like to make a motion to accept the Summer of 13, Summer of Lucky 13, the advertising buy, including the increase in New York and New Jersey and with Pittsburgh, and Brent, everybody in the room was very, very excited about Pittsburgh, so thank you for that. And also expanding our social media to Instagram, which I think is going to be exciting.
Councilmember Matresik?
Second.
I have a motion by Council Secretary Knight and a second by Council Member Matresik to approve the MGH advertising buys. Council Member Pillows.
I just wanted to ask Donna, or some, maybe Mary, was there any business, the business people that are on the commission now, was there any other idea that got turned down, or was this fully embraced and accepted? And
all the votes were unanimous. I mean, there was some discussion on, you know, more time in New York, New Jersey versus, mm-hmm. you know, including Pittsburgh. But I think what we came up with out of two options presented was kind of a hybrid of, and the way we do that is to maintain the same weeks that we were doing in Baltimore, Hilly, and D.C., and then include Pittsburgh and still expand New York, New Jersey. Yeah. So I think we're going to be able to accomplish
that. It's really important that the business community fully
Absolutely.
Embraces this, so the 110%.
I did not have any see any naysayers in the group at all.
Okay, thanks.
And Councilmember Ashley.
And the other, longer summer campaign is in the talking stages or on hold, or that's not, we're not voting on that?
Well, we won't. We'll discuss, because we'll get you more answers for that.
Yeah, we need to make sure it's not going to.
We just wanted to present it tonight. We didn't. We didn't expect a decision. We don't really want a decision. Personally, I didn't look at it as a political ad, but I think it really would be important, to even more so if there's even that perception there, to not even touch it until the legislature is done for the year.
Completely. Right. I have a motion by Councilmember Knight and a second by Councilmember Tressis to move forward with MGH advertising. All those in favor? Vote is unanimous. Thank you very much. Thank you, Andy.
Thank you
for being here. Good job.
Thank you, Andy.
You did a much better job than I think Mary would have done.
Yes, much better. Because I'm still a novice at Instagram.
All right. Next on our agenda is recognition of Christine Vickers, our Fire Department Paramedic of the Year. Chuck, Chief? Buck, you want? Oh, there you are. There you are. I couldn't. I know he was sitting down there earlier. I couldn't find him.
Yeah. Mayor, Council President, members of the Council, members of the public. It's a very nice evening to be here this evening. I want to first off recognize that Tina's family is here. Her husband is here. Her father's here. Her mother-in-law is here to enjoy this occasion with us. And we're here. And I want to also recognize the Ocean City Paramedic Foundation, who sponsors the award. The President Buck Mann is here, the members of the public, and Nancy Howard is here. The Paramedic Foundation provides us a great deal of support for projects and education, and there's a lot of stuff we wouldn't be able to do without their support. And I can tell you the men and women of the Fire Department, Fire EMS, very much appreciate what the Foundation does for us.
We appreciate what you do.
Thank you. I want to introduce to you, and some of you may know her already in the room, Christina Vickers. Christina is the 2012 Ocean City Fire Department Paramedic of the Year. She is a native of Chestertown, Maryland. She is a graduate of Kent County High School. She is an honors graduate of Warwick Community College. She will graduate in May from Wilmington University with a bachelor's degree in allied health education and management. She has been an Ocean City employee with the fire department since 2000. She holds numerous fire service certifications. She's a National Pro Board Fire Officer 4. She is an instructor for CPR and Advanced Cardiac Life Support. She's a certified pump operator, rescue technician, hazardous materials operations certified. She's been a nationally registered paramedic since 1997. She's a Maryland Instructor Certification Review Board Emergency Services level instructor, and she teaches for the Maryland Fire and Rescue Institute. On top of that, she is a published author. She has written a book about autism. It's called Mom's Wish, Finding a Path Through the Autism Maze, and it talks about her family's journey through autism. And she also helps other people who have children with autism sort of get through the system, and that's a very nice thing. And we're very proud of Tina's contribution that way. Tonight we honor her, one, as a skilled paramedic and firefighter. She provides excellent patient care to the residents and visitors to Ocean City. And also, we want to recognize her for her contributions to the fire department. She, on a regular basis, teaches medical continuing ed for my coworkers and myself sometimes. And we very much appreciate her contribution to the fire department. So it is a great honor that I want to present to Tina the Paramedic of the Year Award on behalf of the Fire Department and the Paramedic Foundation. And thank you very much. would like to say something?
This is such an honor, and I am so grateful for my coworkers and the people that I work with doing this. All of us are a team, and it's not just one person. It's the whole team that works together. So thank you guys so much.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Yep.
Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you for being here. Mr. Mayor.
Well, I certainly want to congratulate Christina, but also want to follow up on what was said with regard to the Paramedic Foundation, and the president I know is here, and Nancy, are you secretary? And secretary of the Paramedic Foundation, and they have a dedicated committee, and they've put together a fund that will sustain their ability to continue to provide equipment to our fire company for many years to come, and they've been a great asset, and it's just another example of the city working in partnership with our citizens to make this town even better than it is, and that's hard to imagine. So, Buck, thank you all. Please take back our thanks to the Paramedic Foundation.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Next on the agenda, we have the consent agenda. There's items A through F. The first one is private event approval request for the Dew Tour for June 20th to the 23rd. Also, there's a private event request for ESA Regional Surfing Championship from May 9th to the 12th. Next is a private event approval request for the Play It Safe, various dates from May and June. There's private event approval request for the Soccer Resort Beach Tournament, August 3rd and August 4th. There's a private event approval request for Out of the Darkness Community Walk, September 28, 2013. And also private event approval request for the Wedding on the Beach, on the Boardwalk, for October 18th, 2013. Councilmember Ashley.
Well, I have a question on 6C and 6D, and I have one general question as well, if I could. 60. I noticed on all the special events, including the Dew Tour, that the insurance maximum is, or the insurance requirement is $1 million.
Right.
Is that, I mean, whether you have a small soccer tournament or the Dew Tour, it's still $1 million. Is that?
Right. I'll let Guy answer that one for us.
That's been the town's policy, $1 million coverage.
Is there any reason why that couldn't be increased if need be? Or, I mean, it just seems like if you have a small tournament, it's getting $1 million, and you have a big event that's $1 million, it doesn't seem like, seems like there'd be more liability on a bigger event than a smaller event.
Well, the exposure to liability may be greater on a bigger event. You're not necessarily going to have a claim of that size that just because the event's bigger.
Well, but I'm saying you could have multiple injuries in a bigger event.
Well, that's why I said the exposure is greater.
Correct. So
That's up to you.
Well,
now, you understand it. Once you start getting over $1 million, insurance becomes very difficult to obtain. Right. Now, probably the Dew Tour wouldn't have problems getting it, but
soccer tournament
type of event that we have here and the sponsors of those events probably couldn't get much insurance above those limits. But it's maybe a better question for Eric to answer than myself.
Okay, thank you.
All right, thank you, Councilmember. Councilmember Dare. I'm sorry, Brent. You have one more question.
C, D, and F be taken off the consent agenda.
I have C and D as well. So
C, D, and F.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right, Councilmember Knight.
Then I'll make a motion to accept the consent agenda except for item C, D, and F as part of the Dew Tour.
Okay. Councilmember Pillis?
Yes.
You'll second?
Dew Tour.
I'm going to get a second.
I'm not seconding. Okay. I have a question.
I'll second.
Actually,
the reason for the motion and the second is to take them off the consent agenda so we can discuss them.
Right, exactly.
Oh, did he say A?
No.
I didn't hear A.
No, he said C.
C, D, and F.
I can amend it to make A.
Okay.
I'll amend it to make it A, C, D, and F. We need a second.
All right, Councilmember Matresi?
I'll second.
C.
All right. So we're going to get a motion to approve the consent agenda, B items B and E.
Wait a minute. Okay.
All right. Okay. I have a motion and a second. All those in favor to approve items B and E? Mm-hmm. The vote is 7 in favor with nothing in opposition. I'm sorry, I'm all screwed up here. All right, Councilmember Phyllis.
Dutour.
One at a time.
Dutour.
Let's go to A. What's the first one? Very good.
Okay.
All right.
All right. I just wanted to get some kind of idea. I know that we won't have the total cost until the Dutour is finished because we don't know exactly what services. But what was under number 8, the town's responsibility for providing, we should have a cost on things we already know because you have a footprint from the last 2 years as an example of, you know, the pickup truck and the lot and the bucket truck and the flatbed. I mean, you know these are the items that are going to be used, but we didn't get any cost on that. And your suggestion is that it was 97, our in-kind services for last year. Maybe you're suggesting it's probably going to be the same because it's the same items?
Or maybe more.
Yeah, well, I know that, but I'm trying to get some kind of gauge to what the taxpayer's looking at.
Sorry, council member, yeah, I didn't realize you were looking at me. As the cover memorandum indicates, that what's provided in the background information is the summary of last year's expenditures. We track by department and even by division by assigning a project code for the Dutour. So while it's not provided in this backup material, we can certainly provide that level of detail if there are questions. But the sum of the total in-kind services provided to the Dutour last year to support last year's event totaled $97,151.
Well, the question I've had for several years, and not just with the Dutour, but other special events, is somewhere along the line if we could get a gauge of, you know, what it cost to put 3 police officers there, what it cost to put a flatbed there, what it cost, you know. I know they say that's a difficult process because you don't know what you use, but if you do use these items, you'd have some idea to say, here's the cost, the potential cost.
Sure, and we actually assign an event code to, or project code to every special event that comes to town. So whether it's the air show, whether it's the Dutour, whether or not it's Bike Week, Bike Fest. So we can provide that level of information. Keep in mind, depending on the size of the event, the level of in-kind services, you know, varies.
Yes. And I guess it's my frustration because I've been asking for at least 4 different years for something, not just for this event, but for other events. So we don't really have any cost of what it costs to put bleachers up.
Well, yes, no, we do actually, Mark. We have a spreadsheet of what it costs for our bleachers, our big set of bleachers, or small set of bleachers. Each chair.
The department sent us was not. I didn't think it was clear.
Yeah. Assuming that, regardless of the action on this item tonight, but assuming that it does move forward, we'll provide you the breakout. By project code for that comprises the 97,151.
Okay, thank you. Number 6, it suggests that if there's any changes to the MOU, that's going to be approved by the city manager's office. Any changes?
Right.
Mr. Ricour. So I'm assuming this draft comes out of your office now to us. So I'm just wondering if it's a small or it could be a major change, and for the council not to understand where these changes might occur, and we have no way of, you know, reacting to citizens.
Number six
on the MOU.
Well, 6 is specifically referring to the site diagram and the build schedule as part of the MOU. Any changes to those documents, it's not referring to the MOU as a whole.
Yeah, and that's what I'm saying. If any changes are made on the footprint, this affects merchants. This affects, you know, for example, last year we got a lot of email we got one particular person emailing a lot from the condo down there saying the noise was unbelievable. He wasn't notified. He rented his units out. People were leaving the unit, asking for the money back, and he was losing a lot of rental
investment, his rental investment. So, but we had no way of responding because, well, you know, I myself was unaware that the noise was distracting like that for the people living right on the beach.
I recall that particular situation, you know, very, very vividly.
Well, I guess what I'm suggesting is that maybe we ought to be notified.
Sure, absolutely. And
that it should be there, that not only your office approves it, but however, the council should be notified of changes.
If you feel that is necessary, however, I would, if there were changes to the site diagram or the build schedule, I would by nature notify you of that,
mm-hmm.
simply because I know that you want to be kept abreast of what's happening.
I think if it's clear in the MOU.
That's more of an instruction for me as a responsibility. You know, to mm-hmm. me, you're tasking me with that as opposed to the due tour. This simply acknowledges that any changes would be authorized at the administrative level. I know your expectations, and if there are, I would inform you all.
Okay. So I've set up here for 6 years, and sometimes it's not really clear. And, you know, then people come in, they don't understand these documents because it's never really stated. So I was just trying to make it clear that, you know, the council's involved is at least notified.
I've made a note of it.
And then some of the, like you and CC, some of them have within the footprint, inside the events, you know, promotional footprint, this must be done. But some of the letters do not have it's inside the footprint, and it gives the impression, once again, that they might be able to give away items, you know, on the boardwalk. And if everything would just simply say, if you're prohibited, do this, it has to stay inside. What you do has to stay inside, because I think one of the things that worries the people on the boardwalk is that they'll start to come up there. We had a company do that last year. He went up on the boardwalk two years ago, mm-hmm. gave out towels, gave out boogie boards. You know, it was a bank who did that. And he just didn't understand he wasn't supposed to do it on the boardwalk, so that he was supposed to be within the footprint. And I remember that document wasn't really clear.
Was it 3 years ago?
Yeah.
Is there a reference in the MOU that you're
I just hope that because you've put it in some, it could give the impression that it only applies to, let's say, number, you know.
GG would be one of them.
Yeah. And it should be in, you know, it should be in the GG. I mean, it should be in U. It should be in NN. But I think in general, it just needs to be stated wherever it's not clear, so we don't run into the same problem we have with the bank.
Okay.
And then I noticed on something else we'll be dealing with later on in one of these numbers for the soccer resort beach, and I noticed that wisely the public works department is suggesting that we get a performance bond, and this was talked about maybe a year or more ago,
something like that. Yeah.
Okay. I think Mary and I approached it then, where we thought that was good to start putting into MOUs. So if somebody doesn't perform for whatever reason, I mean, we know everybody, you know, with the goodwill intend, good intentions intended to perform, and especially something like the due tour. But didn't you think a performance bond should be also part of this MOU?
There may have been some discussion regarding a performance bond at the with the internal group that coordinates the review of the MOU. I'd look to Lisa and ask if that was the case. I'm not sure, Council Member.
Per Councilmember Pillis, Public Works, I believe it was Superintendent John Van Fossen had suggested it, and that's up, I would assume, for Council for debate.
Okay. So are we going to debate? We had a discussion some time ago about it, and we thought it would be a good idea, but I don't think it went any further than the discussion.
Right. We do request one for one event in particular. It's the Sandals Beach Soccer. We've had issues with them, and Council did approve a performance bond annually for them of $1,000.
Right.
I believe it's actually $2,000 now.
Yeah, it is.
So,
big difference in the performance bond that would be required for that soccer tournament and the due tour.
Oh,
Yeah. Well, maybe the Due To already has something like that, that they can, maybe they already do. I don't know. It just seems to me that we'll secure the taxpayers.
We've got 2 years of experience working with the Due Tour to suggest that they're going to perform as they say they are.
I know these are very awkward things, you know, to try to get people obligated to their word. And, you know, contracts can be broken. I'm a business person, and I can tell you they're broken. I just was trying to secure the taxpayer on another level. So I don't hear any response up here, so I guess I'm not going to get it.
I'll respond. I don't know how you can require a performance bond for a soccer tournament and not someone else.
I think what happened with the soccer tournament, we did have a problem with them cleaning up the beach and doing the right thing.
Well, but
and with the other promoters, we haven't had that problem. But I think that, you know, it has been stressed that the Public Works has stressed it with the other tournaments to make sure it happens. And that's why the one tournament now is paying that performance bond or putting the bond money up just because they weren't doing the right thing.
But don't you
punish everybody or to make everybody put it up, even though they've been doing the right thing all along. It's like the three-year approval for things. Some things because these people have been performing as well as they should and they've been doing the right thing. And say, now you have to do it because this one guy didn't do it. It's kind of like we're making a law for one person or doing things for one person when other people have been good to us.
But don't you think it's a good policy to ultimately protect the taxpayer to have everybody
put
up a performance bond?
I do. And, you know, and like at the Due Tour, we have 2 years of experience with the Due Tour. I don't know if I know that we have had a problem with the noise as far as the bands playing next to a building and stuff like that, but I haven't heard of anything else as far as a problem with the Due Tour at all. And to ask them to put up a bond big enough to clean up their facility and clean up their site, I don't know what that would be. So, I mean, I'm just trying to be fair to the people that are doing the right thing already.
Yeah.
So I do want to do that. And if we have a problem with somebody doing the wrong thing.
That's the policy. You're stating the policy, and that's very true. If you have history with somebody, you know, and you know, anybody that does business for the first time in the town, you don't ask for performance bonds. You're at the mercy of the world there. Because some of these companies are LLCs, you know, limited liability. But you know, now it seems kind of strange to ask somebody that's already performed well, has a lot to risk to begin with. But somewhere along the line, you got to come up with an idea to say, you know, we're going to let everybody come in town that we don't even know.
Could we possibly make that for new events?
I mean, it's something we can bring to work.
I think this summer be a really good indication as to whether or not it's necessary to include that as a standard provision in our new MOU. You'll all recall June is just slammed with events, and it's going to take a tremendous amount of coordination with staff between the setup and breakdown of events, and there's not an open weekend in June. So if we see, based on the level of activity this summer, that a performance bond may be a good idea, certainly we can revisit that.
Okay. Councilmember Matressing. You're still on. I think you want to know. Go ahead, Margaret.
Number 11, it says that the sole discretion, the town of Ocean City's sole discretion, if an emergency happens, we would dismantle this beach site. Will we bear the expense of that, dismantling that beach site if a hurricane comes? Do we have any provision that says if we give them X amount of days' notice? I mean, they paid to take it down now, and I don't want the Due Tour people to think I'm picking on you. I am not picking on you. I'm just trying. This is a new thing. We're really honing down on MOUs, and so you just happen to be the person we're discussing it about. But, you know, this is something we've talked about. We got to get an MOU for everybody now so we all understand whose responsibilities and what they are clear enough. And so I'm just – because this is a draft, I'm sort of not picking on the company as much as I'm, you know.
Well, both 10 and 11 are written such that it gives the town the discretion in 10 for security. If we're not satisfied with the level of security that the event is providing, and again, this is based off of a standard MOU. Councilmember Pillis is right. It's not necessarily only related to the Due Tour. Yeah. It happens to be the Due Tour that we're talking about right now. But I think you'll find that the operational security provision is standard in each MOU that we'll present to you, as well as 11 as it pertains to evacuation of the beach or dismantling of the site. Mm-hmm. If there's an order to evacuate and we don't receive cooperation from the event promoter or organizer, we're going to take it down. And we're going to hold them responsible for it financially. Mm-hmm. So will we advance the funds? I mean, again, that will increase the level of in-kind support, if you will. But I think
I know that
reimbursement of that.
The Dude Tour has been very forthright, and they came the very first time they were here and said they were going to take care of any costs that they incurred outside of normal business. And they've been very good about that. But this MOU, to me, is the draft for everybody, and we've had trouble. You know, it's not been clear, and I don't think that's clear. I think anybody that got this MOU would assume, I sort of did, that the town, you're doing it on the sole discretion, and you are solely responsible for paying for that dismantle. And I certainly don't want the taxpayers to have to pay for
what
that.
What it's intended to mean is that we don't have to have their permission.
Okay. It has nothing to do with the cost. The cost is on them. And then the last thing is that the town receives no portion of the revenue from the tour. That's sort of like unusual, seems how they pay the bills. So we do get revenue from them. Seems an unusual clause.
Again, based on experience with other private events where we were in a revenue sharing agreement, this simply specifies that that's not the case. It is simply to clarify that we're not going to receive a revenue from the Dew Tour as we have with others.
Right. To me, it ought to be eliminated.
It could be.
And put in place where we do have a MOU that has.
And we're moving away from that now.
Yes.
So I don't disagree that it could be eliminated.
Yes. See, I was making a little something. I'm sorry. Thanks, and sorry, I didn't mean to. Okay. And that's it. Thank you.
Councilmember Matressi.
Just as a, if we want these events to continue to come and be here to bring people to the town of Ocean City, put the famous heads in beds and people in the restaurants and on the boardwalk and all, I would caution the council to consider the performance bond. As somebody who has to secure performance bonds with an impeccable credit rating, I will tell you it's very, very expensive to do so. And a lot of these nonprofits and a lot of these smaller groups are not going to be able to secure them. So that would be my only thing. If you want them to come, you know, we really have to think about that.
Well, I definitely want the Dew Tour to come, by the way. So,
yes.
So,
I think we want them all to come.
I think we do. We really do. And this is a major event, and I know that my kids are looking forward to it. They really are. So, anyway, as we move forward, I need a motion to approve.
So moved.
Councilmember Tressi?
So moved.
Councilmember
Item A, to approve Item A in the consent agenda.
Second.
I have a motion by Councilmember Matresik and a second by Councilmember Knight to approve the request for the Dew Tour for June 20th and 23rd, 2013. You on for a second?
Was.
All those in favor? Vote is 7 in favor. Thank you very much. Sorry. Yep. Hopefully everything will work well. We don't have to tear it down. So we want sunny weather this time, though. Yep. Thank you. All right. Moving on. We have our next is a private event approval request for Play It Safe, various dates. May and June. Councilmember Dare.
Let me first say to Donna, I deeply appreciate everything you and your committee does for the youth that come to Ocean City in June to celebrate their graduation from high school. I have one concern, and that has to do with the behavior on the buses, so it's not necessarily a reflection on Play It Safe, only to the extent of the wristbands that are given to the students. The transportation value that's placed in the agenda of $133,000 just kind of shocked me a little bit, but I understand that that's just the value of what the fare would be if everybody rode at, and paid the fee.
Every time.
What concerns me, though, is not the loss in revenue from the fee, but the loss in the buses from service when they're not destroyed necessarily, but windows broken and rails removed and cleanups necessary and that. And more so, the drivers that come on board in the spring and quit shortly after experiencing mm-hmm. some of the behavior of some irresponsible young adults. And I think during, or I intend during our budget hearings and working with the police commission and even recreation to pursue more what we can do to maintain better behavior during this time period from some of these visitors. And I bring it up under this request for Play It Safe events just to ask that they be very diligent in dispensing the wristbands that to be sure that it's the participants, because the young adults that come and participate are the responsible ones, and they're not the ones I'm talking about, but I want to make sure that as you interact with them, that it's those that are young adults are giving the wristbands for the bus rides and not merely some that may come and not participate. So I just ask that of the committee, and would then with that make a motion that we approve this special event permit.
I got a motion by Councilmember Dare. Councilmember Knight?
Second.
I have a question.
I got a motion by Councilmember Dare and a second by Councilmember Knight to approve Play It Safe various dates from May through June. Yeah. Councilmember Ashley, got a question?
Well, yeah, I'm a little confused. I know you weren't here last year, Dennis, but Mr. Recor, when he first came into town, the first night he was here, we rode the bus, former council member Joe Hall, myself, and Mr. Recor. And then there was discussion among the councils. I recall emails back and forth where we were trying to determine how much of a problem the riders were on the bus. And as I recall, and I'd have to go back and look, but some thought they were a problem and some thought there wasn't a problem. So could you comment on that, Mr. Recor, exactly?
There weren't a lot of wristbands that night that we rode the bus.
There was not a lot of wristbands, I'm sorry.
No, sir.
Okay.
It wasn't a play. The behavior at the time was not related to the participants in the Play It Safe event, at least on the evening that we spent evaluating the transportation system.
Correct. And Dennis said about the broken windows and so forth, and I know we had that discussion, at least on email last year, and I think the bottom line was there really wasn't that much damage or vandalism in June. Am I correct?
We don't have to suppose. We have our transportation supervisor
okay.
here
oh, that's right. okay.
who can speak directly to the issue.
All right.
But sure. I believe that's accurate.
George?
Well, every year during Play It Safe, we monitor everything that goes on in a 24-hour period. The first thing I do when I come in the next morning is write up a report of what happened the 24 hours prior to 7 a.m., list all the damages, any events that went on. Last year was not a bad year. Did we have some problems? Yes. Did we lose a couple drivers? I think we lost two. And it really was not a bad year last year. We have had worse years than that. So I don't consider last year a problem year at all, really, when I compare it to other years gone by. We work very closely with the police department. We work very closely with, I'm going to name Donna because she's always the one I always call to get information.
But George, wasn't one of the preventive measures, wasn't there a supervisor assigned along the highway at certain places?
There is supervisors that we put in strategic places during peak hours at that location. We do that all summer long. We don't just do it for the month of June. And those supervisors move from location to location when needed.
But I recall we stepped up something in June last year. Remember, former council member Hall had made a suggestion, and I can't remember what it was.
Why is not here?
We did talk about that. We kept using that same practice.
Okay.
Did we devote more people to it? I think at one point we did, and that was like the third week of the Play It Safe.
Okay. And just in summation, was there a lot of broken windows and damage to the buses last year?
There was not. The one thing I will note, out of nine summers I've been here, we had more cleanups, interior-wise, than we've had in 9 years, for whatever reason.
What do you mean, clean up?
Interior cleanups.
You mean
vomit,
fluids. Liquid,
oh, yeah.
Bodily
yeah.
fluids?
Yeah. He didn't have to say that, but yeah.
Wait,
yeah. Yep.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Yes, can you show
us? Okay. What was the total ridership last year in the buses? Do you have
it? I don't have that handy.
Okay. All right, just want to know.
But I can certainly give it to you tomorrow.
You're going to have problems when you have that many people riding the bus, I'm sure. So.
Well, you know, that's a good point. I'd like to address that. In the past 5 years, we've averaged 3 million people plus. When you look at that, 5 months, May 1 through September 30th, we've averaged moving 90% of those in a five-month period. So you're saying we moved 2.6 million people on a 4.6 square mile island in 5 months.
So you're going to have a few problems.
You could have,
yeah,
yes.
Thank you.
Okay.
All right. Councilmember Pillows.
I'm looking at the schedule that was sent to us, and I'm not sure that, I mean, Play It Safe, you know, is working sometimes at the same time that the air show is setting up and then the do tours trying to set up while the air show is breaking down.
Yes, ma'am.
And sometimes you have three activities. Just to lay this out for me, are they in different areas where we're not going to have people breaking down and setting up when...
No,
I can't even understand how this is going to take place here.
It is going to be a challenge, but I'll let Lisa respond.
Oh, let me ask you a question before you get there. I see it's tentative. Has it been secured, the date at this point, for Play It Safe? I mean,
it's tentative until you vote on it.
Oh, until we vote on it. Yeah. But
some events take place in the different locations, others where they're in the same location. I'm thinking one in particular with Play It Safe and a soccer tournament that's happened annually, and they've come to work together pretty well to not really interfere yeah. with each other's events. I think everybody works very well to try to have each person's or each coordinator's event be the best it can be for the town.
Yeah, I'm sure. But I guess really my concern is overtime from the Public Works Department. I mean, this seems to be a Public Works Department nightmare.
It's a good point, Council Member, and that's why we brought this calendar to you several months ago to identify the challenge that we're facing, particularly as you consider, you know, new events and new requests. Because for everybody that is devoted to providing the in-kind support that's necessary to support these events, that means something else isn't getting done. That
right.
takes them away from their everyday responsibility. Be that as it may, you're right. It is a challenge, and so far the staff has risen to the occasion. I don't expect anything different this summer.
All right. When I saw this a couple months ago, I was under the impression we were working on it. I wasn't under the impression it was going to be sent back to me in the same time.
There's definitely
same dates.
You know, overlap and setup and coordination. We have two very big events in the air show and the do tour, and it's going to be an exciting June.
Yeah, there you go. I mean, bring more people. Councilmember Ashley.
Well, Don, I echo what Dennis said. I'm very appreciative of what you do. And I could tell you not too long ago, I was talking to the mayor of a New Jersey resort town, and he was aware of the Play It Safe program down here, and he was asking me questions because they also have young people come there in June. So he was very inquisitive and asked me several questions, and I actually gave him your name, okay, if he wanted additional information. My question is this, just, and this is probably happening every year, on the insurance waiver. Have you requested the insurance waiver every year? Is that?
Yes.
And that's okay?
Mm, we've never, no problem.
No problem?
Mm-hmm. You all approved it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yep.
Okay.
I didn't.
You break me up, guy. I thank you. Talk about a fun guy. I mean, you know.
You're giving me that look. So
I'm just well, I'm just, you know, without my glasses, I can't see that clear, so I'm just looking. I'm waiting for a response, but okay. All right. I'm good with that, if that's okay.
I have a motion by Councilmember Dare and a second by Councilmember Knight to approve the Play It Safe from May and June. All those in favor? Vote is unanimous. Thank you very much. Okay. Moving on. Basically, it is private events approval request for the soccer resort beach tournament for August 3rd and 4th, 2013. Councilmember Dare.
I asked to be able to discuss that as well. You know, this is August 3rd. I think that's the beginning of White Marlin Week in Ocean City. It's the largest tourism week in Ocean City, and we're being asked to take five blocks beach out of use during the height of the season for a private event. I mean, I think these events are good to fill in, you know, say in the shoulder season or in a soft part of the season, but in at the biggest week of the year, we're taking and using five blocks of beach for someone's private event. So I'm not going to be able to support it. I just wanted to see if there was something I was missing.
Is this a new event? Is this a new event, or is this an event that was here?
It is a new event. Mm-hmm. The gentleman was Niall Swan. The event organizer is from New Jersey. He was coming down today to be here. Unfortunately, he had a family emergency and had to go back home midway here. But it is definitely a new event.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Councilmember Knight.
Oh, I'm sorry. That's in response to what Councilmember Dare said, and I also asked if it's a new event. That's why it's really imperative. We've got to come up with a return on investment on these events. We know the White Marlin Tournament, we did an economic study, as I recall, Councilmember Dare, several years ago, and I think the economic impact, I can't remember, it was in the millions of dollars. I want to say it was like $11 to $13 million for the White Marlin Tournament. The state of Maryland did that study, and that was probably 4 years ago. So when you weigh that against a brand new event that none of us know anything about, to me the decision is pretty obvious. So I also will not support this at this time, or we could table it and get more information. I don't know.
It's two dates to choose from. It's August 3rd or August 4th. It's a Saturday or a Sunday. We could look at that as well. What I think, I'm trying to look at the calendar here. White Marlin Open is the 5th, 6th.
Yeah.
5th, 6th, 7th, 8th, and 9th.
Fishing day.
So it's actually the weekend before the White Marlin. If you look at doing it maybe on the Saturday, because of Saturday being a changeover day, you might get the people holding over for the tournament. You might get your return on your investment that way as far as room nights go. It's something to look at. It doesn't have any potential. It says August 3rd or 4th, but what I was confused on is which day is, you know, whether we're talking about a rain date or a whole date or what.
The rain date is the 4th.
Yeah, right. So you're looking at the 3rd being the actual date. I don't know.
I think living right next to the White Marlin Tournament, they set up, you know, on Saturday, as I recall, you can still, you know, there's a lot of activity there, a lot of activity. But anyway, maybe we should just table it, you know, instead of saying no.
Okay. Councilmember Tressie.
Mr. President, we
we might, in fact, be doing this gentleman a favor by canceling it for this weekend for the simple reason that I don't know that if any of his attendees or people that may attend would be able to get rooms that starting that week. So, I mean, we may be asking him to possibly put it off to the fall or another time.
I mean, so, if the way it looks, there's...
it's up to what the council says, but I think we may, in fact, be doing this gentleman a favor.
Yeah. Okay. Mr. Mayor.
Well, I'd suggest you remand it to the Park and Rec Advisory Committee and have him meet with them and talk through that, maybe try to move it to another week, maybe a little later in August when we can use the room nights.
Yes. Yeah.
That's a good idea.
They can report back to the mayor and council.
Right. Sound good?
That's exactly where we were going.
I knew it.
All right. It sounds...
I make a motion we remand the soccer tournament for... Saturday, August 3rd, to the Recreation and Parks Committee for further review.
All right. Councilmember Knight?
Second.
I have a motion by Councilmember Tressing and a second by Councilmember Knight to remand the Soccer Resort Beach Tournament for August 3rd and 4th to Parks and Rec Committee. All those in favor? Voted 7 in favor. Thank you. Okay. Next on the agenda is a private event approval request for wedding on the boardwalk for October 18th, 2013. Councilmember Dare?
I also asked for that to be able to speak to that because the memorandum requests a couple decisions. And the first is I'd move to approve this with two conditions. One, that it be considered as a nonprofit. And secondly, that the Public Works will not be able to provide the benches.
All right, I got a motion for Councilman Dare to approve their request as a nonprofit and Public Works will not be able to provide the benches. Councilmember Pillis.
I'll second that.
All right, I have a motion by Councilmember Dare and a second by Councilmember Pillis to approve the wedding on the boardwalk for October 18, 2013 for Emily. Welcome. All those in favor? The vote is 7 in favor. Good luck.
Congratulations.
Yeah, congratulations.
Cool. Yeah.
I told you it would be quick. It wasn't quick, was it?
We're sorry.
How's that consent agenda working?
That consent agenda is not working very well.
I make a motion
like, good luck with everything,
with
honestly.
Consent agenda.
Yeah. Oh, no, we got some.
I told him he might have a few bumps with that.
Yeah. All right, next on the agenda is bid openings for vehicle franchise, vending franchise. Council Secretary Knight, would you give me the honor?
City Manager
David Recourt.
Yes, ma'am.
Mr. Mayor, while they're coming up.
Well, just to follow up on the request that was made, that's a council decision, but we did have a request that we postpone or extend the period of time for these to be out to bid because there are additional people that, for whatever reason, didn't have the opportunity. I mean, I think everybody had equal opportunity. I think it was advertised correctly. And I think that, you know, that's how we do everything. But I noticed there's also another email here from somebody else that said the same thing. You know, the council has the right to reject any bids if they don't think they're appropriate. But then at the same time, if you do that and open it back up, everybody knows what the first bids were. So just to recognize the request that was made, I think you ought to make a decision whether you're going to open the bids as they are or if you're going to extend.
All right. Councilmember Matresic.
How many bids do we have?
Three.
How many bids do we have last time that we bid this?
I'm sorry, sir. I don't recall.
It was
a while ago because it was extended.
Yeah, it was
extended.
A long time ago.
It's been
extended
for a while.
I'm not lobbying for it. I just think the request
was trying
was made.
To think back myself. There's twofold here. As somebody who regularly works in the bid field, I mean, if I got mine in on time and had it ready to go and it was rejected because somebody came in and said they didn't have enough time, I would be pretty furious, to be honest with you. So unfortunately, I think I'd have to make a motion that we go forward with the three bids that we have present.
All right. I got a motion by Councilmember Matresti to go forward with the three bids. Councilmember Ashley.
No, I'll hold.
All right. Councilmember Pillis.
I have a question.
Councilmember Simak.
I just wanted to comment that I think it puts the three people that have bid.
We have a motion. You have to second.
Yeah. Well, you second it. Yeah. I'm sorry.
I'll second it.
Yeah. I'm sorry. That's what I thought you were doing.
And it also say that it puts those people at a disadvantage if we delay this. They've got to mobilize and get ready for the summer, and I wouldn't want to see any tremendous extension to this if in fact we did do it.
All right, I got a motion by Councilmember Trestick and a second by Councilmember Simak to open the three bids that we have and not postpone them. All those in favor? Oh, I'm sorry, discussion? I mean, you said you had a discussion.
Well, right. So he said tremendous. He didn't say he was against it. He said I wouldn't want it to be a tremendous long time. So he's not actually against doing it, and the discussion is still on the floor. I have a concern that if we have a second person here, I mean, when we get bids in, there are circumstances. I myself have accepted them, as a councilwoman, saying this is the circumstance. So now we have a second person. I was not in favor of the first one because it was given time. But now that I know a second person is involved, I agree with the mayor, or I don't know if he's agreeing to do this, but I hearing that there's a second person tells me that there was something not correct and not understood by the public. And we're here to make sure the public, does understand. I mean, it's not like these three bids go away, correct? We keep these three. They're sealed. We don't know a price. We can't give the new people any heads up, so they got an advantage over these three. I mean, it's already sort of sealed and it's done. And can it really cause harm? I know it puts more competition for these three, but we're in the business basically of trying to get the best deal. And I'm not so sure that this gentleman is wrong about temperature. I mean,
yeah, but that's not part of the bid spec.
It's not part, but that's my point. Maybe we overlook something. Maybe we overlook the fact that it should be part of a bid.
Well, hold on. Basically, what I can tell you is being up here for quite a few years, and we've had bids come in a half hour late while we're in closed session, and we don't accept those bids because they came in a half hour late.
Yeah,
they had appropriate amount of time to get their bid together, like everybody, the three bidders up there did. Not saying it's wrong, right, wrong, or indifferent, but we've all voted to reject those bids that were a half hour late because FedEx or somebody else didn't deliver them on time. Yeah. And they had enough time the day before to get their bid out there. So we have rejected those bids. So I understand where Councilmember Trestick is when you put all this bid together and they took the time to do it and do it in the right amount of time. It would be kind of doing them injustice to be approving the other people to go ahead and bid.
No question about it. I thought I said that. It's not fair. Right. In some way to anybody. It's not fair to the taxpayers. It's not fair to these people. Somebody's got to be left out. It's just a discussion.
Why are we
talking? It's a discussion. That's all.
Councilmember Petrosic, you like on?
Well, I'll go back to, you say it doesn't affect the three. They took the time. Maybe they rushed through their bids. Maybe they didn't look at them as closely as they did because they wanted to get them in quickly because they wanted to meet the deadline. Again, when you're in the business to bid, when your line of work is to bid on things and you meet deadlines to bid and you put the time in to do so, you go out there and you find the dates that it's due and everything. And then for us to postpone it because a gentleman came in and said that he's smart and has quality and talks about the way ice cream may crystallize is not very fair to these three people that took the time to put these bids in on time. And I'm sorry, that's the way I feel.
Right.
I do, before we vote, I do have a question about the, it says in the number three, where's Mr. Becor? Or I'm sorry. Mrs. Salm. It says in number three, the operator shall be permitted to vent. It's that paragraph. When you get down to the second sentence, he shall not be permitted to, and it says non-food items. Does that mean he can't put water there? Because the above says he can use beverage. He can use food and beverage, but the second sentence says he cannot vent
I read that as he can't sell boogie boards out of the
Sanchez truck.
It's non-food items.
Yeah, I know what it means because I understand.
Those type of
because I understand the ordinance. I'm just talking about water.
Okay. Well, water is covered under beverages.
Yeah.
Right. You can sell one.
But water's not considered food, and that's what I was objecting to. I mean, I thought it wasn't clear. That's all. Thank you.
All right.
God forbid we should get these documents clear.
I have a motion by Councilmember Tresick and a second by Councilmember Simak to open the three bids as they stand. All those in favor? I have. All in favor. All right. Thank you. All right.
Councilmember Knight out of the room. Oh,
no, she's up here.
She's up there.
Yeah, I was saying she's not in her seat, but that's why I looked around.
I lost her.
You got to stop wearing black.
I better get rid of these glasses. I do have a comment.
All right, Mr.
Before you open them, I do have a comment. I just want to follow up on what Ms. Dinkelman said. If you look at page 136 of our agenda and you look at section 39504, system established franchise conditions, award a franchise, it specifically tells you everything about the franchise, what you can sell, where you can sell it, how you can sell it, how many trucks you can have. The operator shall be permitted to vend at retail prepared food and beverage items, excluding alcoholic beverages. He shall not be permitted to vend non-food items. So that would be boogie boards or any of those type of things. Goes on to say, basically everything that you need to know, the hours of operation, where he's prohibited from, must be prepared food items, but everything is spelled out very clearly right in that section, exactly what the intent of this franchise is. It's a food item. You can sell hot dogs.
Yep.
Okay.
If you would, please, open the bids. No. Thank you.
Any other comments that can be made?
No.
No, sir.
No.
Go ahead, Damon.
Okay.
Oh, what's the name of this company? The first bid is from Popsy Pop LLC in Somerdale, New Jersey. There is a bid bond, and let's find how much money.
Popsy Pop. I guess POP.
It's $71,200 per year for a total of $284,800 for the 4-year term.
All right. Feel very well.
They didn't trust him with the little ripper tonight. There is a bid bond.
It's from?
I'm looking.
Okay.
From Brian McCarthy on North Baltimore Avenue in Ocean City, Maryland. And it's $20,000 per year for a total of $80,000 for the 4-year term. It's double sealed. It's in three envelopes.
It's a sealed bid.
It is a sealed bid. There is a bid bond, and it's from gosh knows. Ice cream vending in Uniontown, Pennsylvania. There is a bid bond, and this gentleman's quoting $6,375 per year for a total of $25,500 for the 4-year term.
All right. Thank you. All right. Councilmember Matresi.
I would like to acknowledge the apparent high bid from Popsy Pop LLC and to remand to the city clerk for the proper background checks and so on and so forth to move forward.
All right. I have a motion by Councilmember Tresnick and a second by Councilmember Simak. All those in favor?
Yes, sir.
Vote is unanimous. Thank you, Mary, very much.
Thank you, Popsy Pop.
Yeah, maybe. If not, second bidder gets it.
It's interesting. They're from New Jersey. Maybe there's a reason for this.
Yeah.
It could very well be.
Sure.
Yeah, that's interesting.
Kelly, thank you.
You're welcome. I'm up next.
Yep, coming up. All right. Go ahead. Okay. Take off.
In the audience tonight is Mary Manganiello. Gosh, I had it right the first time. Manganiello. She has brought forward the MOU, which we had last year. Let me slow down. This is very similar to last year's MOU, except for, and if I may point out, that they're requesting $3,500 a year, I mean, for this season, for staffing. And if you would like to explain that, Mary Ann.
Yes, this is the fourth year that we've had this agreement with the city. And we originally were only to provide, I believe it was 5 hours a day from 5 to 8 p.m. Thursdays through Sundays. Mm-hmm. Each year we have used our own funds and our volunteers to beef up the staffing on the cottage. And last year we did noon to 8 p.m. 7 days a week, plus the shoulder season. In May and September, we also provided Saturday coverage there. So our costs have gone up, and we feel that we provide a very important asset to the city by doing this, and to our members by having their materials available for everyone. So we would just like to ask for a little help for the city, and we can continue to provide the service.
Mr. Mayor, your light was on first.
Yeah, there was a question about this brought up during the comments from the citizens about why we would pay $3,000 or $3,500, because it was costing us a lot more when we paid city staff to operate it. This way, they're there, they're utilizing the space, they're the downtown association, they know the area, they bring their members in or volunteers, many of the people sitting up here have volunteered, mm-hmm. and it costs us less to do it that way than it would be if we paid or hired a city employee right. to be in there. So it's a win-win for the downtown association and the city.
All right, thank you, Mr. Mayor. Councilmember Matresic.
That's yes. the answer.
Actually, I was...
You had your question, that's your answer. Yeah.
Going to actually answer the question also, but I will make a motion to approve the MOU with the Downtown Association in regards to the Boardwalk Cottage Information Center and move forward.
Councilmember Pillis.
I'll second that, and I also would like to answer the question that was brought forth. Oh. This is our obligation for everybody listening. That we own this. This is our obligation, and I spearheaded the Downtown Association to come forward and volunteer some time. It would benefit them. I tried to build up, it would benefit them greatly. However, I always knew that it would benefit this town far more, because not only do they supply information about different businesses all over town, they also supply a security. People get lost, people are looking for direction, people need information about our events, and they do that service for us as well. So we do not have an employee standing there getting overtime, and it's a real bargain. It's really a bargain. Mm-hmm. So, and you're not talking about any money. I mean, you're not even 35. I mean, we're open we're actually 100 days in the season. You go there 5 days. I mean, you're not making.
It actually ends up being about 850 hours.
Yes. Totally. And so you're down to somewhere like, I don't think it was like 350 or something an hour. So this is a bargain, and it's needed. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Mary, thanks for being here. I got a motion and a second. All those in favor? Vote is unanimous. Thank you. Thank you, Kelly.
You didn't mean me.
All right. Next on the agenda is items referred to in presentation from the city solicitor. Guy?
Second reading, ordinance 2013-3 adopts FY13 budget amendment number one.
Councilmember Knight.
A motion to pass second reading of budget amendment number one.
Councilmember Matresik.
Second.
I have a motion by Councilmember Knight and a second by Councilmember Matresik to approve the ordinance for 2013-3. Councilmember Pillows.
Yes, I just want to approach the question that was asked about the $45 per hundred. I don't know if I can give an answer to that, but I think this is the point in time in which we should try to answer the question from someone who's asked for this. Is this, I think the question was, does it apply to our a fee, a property tax?
No, it's no what tax, was there's the, no tax increase. I don't know what she was talking about. But
yeah, well.
That's the existing tax rate.
Right. That's
the
tax rate. Just the tax rate, what it is now. Yeah, I heard Margaret say 40, you probably meant 45 cents, not 40, you said 45 dollars.
Well, I was just trying to
confused.
Understand.
That's why I was confused when he said
yeah.
Dollars.
No. Well, she can.
Well, let me ask you to come up because I don't quite understand your question, and I wanted to ask it, but I had my light on to ask it when you were up here. But
Mr. Mayor.
Well, the relevance, and the city manager can speak to it, amendment number one puts forward all the changes to the budget that have been made throughout the course of the fiscal
right.
year. Mm-hmm. It's a working document, and there are going to be changes. There are going to be funds shifted from one fund to another. The budget manager, Jenny Knapp, came in and explained to everybody at a work session exactly what all those changes were and how they were derived and how these decisions were made. It hasn't changed anything, hasn't changed the tax rate. It just shows where the money was moved, why it was needed somewhere else, and how those allocations were made.
So I guess the answer, I guess the question you're asking, since I've asked the question, is that the 45 cents per $100 of property value, is that what you're asking, what that actually means, as opposed to $45?
Because he sufficiently answered it just now, saying, meaning that there's no additional dollars.
Correct.
Correct. Okay. Thank you.
I have a motion by Councilmember Knight and a second by Councilmember Matresik to approve the budget amendment number one. All those in favor? That is unanimous. Thank you. Guy, you're up again.
Second reading ordinance 2013-4 to amend chapter 110 titled Zoning Permits Miniature Golf as a Conditional Use in the Downtown Mixed Use Zoning District.
Councilmember Knight.
Motion to accept second reading of the ordinance 2013-4.
All right. I got a motion by Councilmember Knight. Councilmember Matresik.
Second.
I have a motion by Councilmember Knight and a second by Councilmember Matresik to approve ordinance 2013-4. Discussion. Mr. Mayor.
Yes, there was a question about the area where this would be, and actually this was a use that was, I think, allowable previously, and it was removed, and I think it was a mistake that it was removed. And what it does is it allows a miniature golf course by conditional use. And a conditional use means they need to go before the Planning and Zoning Commission, get approval from the Planning and Zoning Commission. The Planning and Zoning Commission can put conditions on that use to make sure it is compatible with the neighborhood. They can make sure it closes at a certain time, that it doesn't have outdoor music, that they have a sufficient number of employees, the employees are a certain age. They can put a lot of conditions on there to make sure that it is adaptable to that area. If it is not and it doesn't meet the test, then they're not going to send a favorable recommendation to the mayor and council. The final decision rests with the mayor and council.
Thank you for answering that question, Mr. Mayor. I have a motion and a second. All those in favor? Vote is unanimous. Thank you. Okay. Guy, you're up again.
Second reading ordinance 2013-5 to amend chapter 110 entitled Zoning. It merely clarifies the calculation of required parking for mixed-use development.
All right. Councilmember Matresik.
Motion to approve ordinance 2013-5 on second reading.
Councilmember Knight.
Second.
I have a motion by Councilmember Matresik and a second by Councilmember Knight to approve ordinance 2013-5. All those in favor? Vote is unanimous. Thank you. All right. Guy, you're up again.
For first reading, ordinance 2013-6, ordinance to amend the general employees and the public safety employees pension plans by changing the trustees to include the mayor and council president and eliminate other council members.
Right.
All right. Councilmember Knight.
Motion to approve the first reading of the ordinance to amend the General Employees and Public Safety Employees Pension Committee members.
All right. I got a motion by Councilmember Knight and Councilmember Simak.
Second.
I have a motion by Councilmember Knight and a second by Councilmember Simak. Discussion? Councilmember Pillows.
I'll be voting against this. As you know, I believe that it should be the Committee of the Whole, so I'm just giving an explanation on record.
Okay. All right. Any other discussion? I have a motion and a second. All those in favor? Vote is 5 in favor with 2 in opposition with Councilmembers Pillows and Ashley in opposition.
Mr. President,
yes.
I'd like to inquire about the procedures of adopting an emergency ordinance. As you all are aware, there is a pension committee meeting scheduled for tomorrow morning. There appears to be some difficulty with reaching a quorum. There are currently 14 members on the committee. Moving this forward, it would reduce the members to 7. We'd only need 4 for a quorum.
Yeah.
So if you adopted it by emergency ordinance, that would there would not be an issue for the quorum for the meeting tomorrow.
Right.
All right, Councilmember Knight.
A motion to make this an emergency ordinance.
All right, I need a second.
I'll second.
All right, got a motion by Councilmember Knight and a second by Councilmember Simak. Discussion? Councilmember Pillows.
I just want to tell the group here and anybody watching that I did confirm I was coming tomorrow. I'm one of the people confirmed. I don't want you to think that I was boycotting an obligation that I had. So now that they're making an emergency, I won't have to be there.
That's
because I won't be on the committee. So just want to make sure people understand that.
I have a motion and a second. All those in favor to make this emergency ordinance? I have 5 in favor with 2 in opposition with Councilmember Ashley and Pillows in opposition.
Emergency ordinance requires the mayor's
Consent.
Yes, I do approve of the emergency ordinance.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. All right, Guy, you're up again.
2013-5.
Resolution 5?
Yes, sir.
Resolution 2013-5, resolution adopting a code of conduct as part of the harassment-free workplace policy of the employee handbook.
All right. Councilmember Matresik.
Motion to approve resolution 2013-5.
Councilmember Knight.
Second.
All right. I have a motion by Councilmember Matresik and a second by Councilmember Knight. Discussion? All those in favor? The vote is 7 in favor. Thank you. Guy, you have one more.
The next item is a debarment proceeding.
We should have said something.
The previous vehicle vending franchise holder has defaulted in his payments, and the council has forfeited his franchise. Under our code, forfeiture of a franchise or a contract can be grounds for debarment. It's not automatic. It's up to you. You have to conduct a hearing. Just for the record, on February the 4th, I wrote to the franchise holder advising him he was in default and demanded payment within 10 days. Payment was not received. I contacted the franchise holder again on February the 20th, advised him that there would be a debarment proceeding scheduled for today's council meeting. I did receive in the by email and by fax this afternoon a letter from the franchise holder. So that's why it's not in your agenda package. I just got it. And actually, it's a copy to me. It's the letter to Kelly. So I will read it in the record. I am writing in response to the letter received from the city solicitor dated February 20th, 2013. While we are disappointed that we will no longer be operating the ice cream vending business in Ocean City, we understand the town of Ocean City's need to place the vehicle vending franchise up for bid. I understand from the agenda for tonight's mayor and council regular session and stated in the February 20th letter that there will be a debarment hearing for JSJ Ventures LLC and Scott Dower individually. I had intended to attend in person, but unfortunately, a personal matter has arisen that precludes me from attending. I want to write and inform you that neither JSJ Ventures LLC nor me personally intend to submit a bid today for the vehicle vending franchise. In addition, we have no immediate plans to pursue any additional contracts with the town of Ocean City. Notwithstanding our lack of intention to pursue any future business with the town, I would ask that you not explicitly prohibit it. As you know, JSJ Ventures has operated an ice cream vending business under the vehicle vending franchise for 6 years. We believe we have enjoyed a very good working relationship with the town, as well with the residents and visitors of Ocean City. We are appreciative of the support we have received from the mayor and council over the past 6 years, and are deeply sorry that we will not be able to continue the operation of our ice cream vending business for the next 2 years. Hey, listen, telephone numbers where you can be reached. Signed, Scott P. Dower, JSJ Ventures, LLC.
Thank you, Guy. Councilmember Matresic.
Well, as rosy as that letter is, it's not been quite what I would consider that good of a relationship, and he has put us in this position that we're in tonight, where we have to move forward with bids that we have people upset about. So I will make a motion that we move forward with the debarment of JSJ Ventures, LLC, and Scott Dower.
Councilmember Knight.
Second.
I have a motion by Councilmember Matresic and a second by Councilmember Knight to move forward with the debarment hearings for JSJ Ventures. Discussion, Councilmember Pillows.
Yes, debarment is a serious situation in any economy, especially in this type of economy. But we never did get an explanation. He's just, he was late to begin with before we even sent him a letter. It seemed to me that he wasn't interested any longer, and now he's interested in not being debarred for what particular reason. He doesn't say in the letter what it is.
Well, if you'll recall, he requested a reduction in the franchise amount, and you all denied
that.
Right.
Uh-huh.
That was the second time he denied.
So he didn't pay this year's initial amount. Mm-hmm.
And when we debar somebody, will you please explain what that means to that person now? What does he have to do to get back into the system?
Yeah. Well, first of all, if you debar him, you then have to decide for how long he's the entity and the person is debarred. Mm-hmm. But what that means is during the period of debarment, that entity and he individually would be precluded from conducting any business with the town.
For the period of time we set in place.
I said for the period that the debarment.
Yeah. So we could do it for 2 years.
You could do it for 2 years, that's correct.
Right. And so he's not able to bid on, let's say, the beach franchise in that 2 years of any type at all.
He can't enter into any contracts with the town of Ocean City during the period of debarment.
All right. Councilmember Steinmeier.
Guy, correct me if I'm wrong. During the process of trying to find out where they were on this, they were non-responsive to some of your communications you sent to them, weren't they? And you sent a letter to them. And
the first letter I sent, I got a call, I guess, on the last day where he told me they weren't going to come up with the money and he knew it was going to be forfeited. The last letter I sent it by email, regular mail, and certified mail. Certified mail came back unclaimed. But then he sent this letter, which I got today.
So between the date of that letter and so today,
he has been responsive.
Okay. Mr. Mayor.
Yeah, just so the public will know, and I think Council President mentioned it, but I don't know if everybody caught it. We've tried to work with this particular vendor. We did reduce the price of the franchise significantly at his request after the second year, I think.
That's correct.
And then he came back and asked for another reduction. And we did not think that it was appropriate to give a second reduction. That's when he decided not to exercise the contract this year, thus we had to terminate the agreement. Thus, we then had to rebid the franchise. Thus, we are now here to debar him. And I think that the town really did work and try to work out a good relationship. Sometimes things just don't work out, but I think debarment's the right way to go, at least for a period of time.
All right. Councilmember Simic.
I'd ask the council to consider possibly a three-year period in this situation. We have had our bumps in the road with him, but maybe he'll learn by this experience and it sends a clear message to other people.
Councilmember Matresi.
Well, yeah. I agree 3 years would probably be a good number, but I will say that this gentleman knew that he was having financial problems in October, September, for that matter, and didn't find it financially applicable to come back again next year at the same price. He could have contacted us in September, October, November, December. He waited till the last minute to even contact. Actually, he was past due, I believe, before he even contacted us. Right. So my thought is that, we really just, until such a time where he thinks he can do business with the town, I don't think we need to have people with those types of issues.
So yours is to amend it to 3 years?
My year would be to amend it to a three-year debarment for JSJ Ventures, LLC, and Scott Downey.
Is that a motion?
Yes.
Okay.
Amend my motion.
I did hear a comment yelled out that it's a four-year contract, but this gives him an opportunity to vote to try some other business other than this particular vending business.
He'll be able to bid on it when it comes up again.
Right.
Yeah, that's exactly right. But he would. Okay, got a motion and a second to make a three-year debarment for JSJ Ventures, LLC, and Scott Dwyer. Discussion? Nope, okay. All those in favor? Vote is 7 in favor. Okay. All right, Guy, thank you very much. And next on the agenda is review of tentative March 26, 2013 work session agenda. I can't talk, though. Running out here.
Thank you, Mr. President. There is a regularly scheduled work session for Tuesday, March 26th. At this time, I'm not aware of any closed session material. There are a number of scheduled absences on that date. The agenda is light. We have a retirement recognition for John Sullivan. We asked if we could put it off till April when we would have a full council, and Sully's will be officially retired at the end of March. So we're going to recognize Sully for his years of contribution to the city. We also have a request to use FY12 Homeland Security grant funds to enhance police in-car technology. It will be presented by a member of the police department. And then the last item to date is a request to purchase 8 TASER electronic control devices, also presented by the police department. One other comment, simply make an observation regarding the comments from the citizens this evening. I think that you all will recall that the reformat of our agenda it results from our discussions during the strategic planning process. Moving comments from citizens to the beginning of the agenda, adding the consent agenda, and then reestablishing the committee and commissions. We're making progress in each one of those regards. Tonight, I think you saw comments from the citizens work effectively. The agenda is posted online on Thursday prior to the Monday regularly scheduled meeting. The background material is available online. Public has the weekend to review that material, identify their issues. I think you saw a citizen tonight take advantage of that, identify issues, allowed the mayor the opportunity to respond to comments at the beginning of the meeting. And that was the purpose for moving comments from the citizens to the beginning of the meeting, is to allow them to speak on any subject matter on a regularly scheduled regular session, as opposed to a work session where top conversation or comment is limited to a scheduled agenda item. But again, the purpose was to provide those comments to the mayor and council in advance of their discussions, and I just thought that tonight you saw it work effectively. So I would encourage you to leave it at the beginning of the agenda as it appears to be working the way it was intended.
Yep.
You know, and as far as the consent agenda goes this evening, there are going to be times where, you know, items are removed off the consent agenda. I know some comments were made, hopefully, in jest. You see, the staff is prepared to discuss them in whatever detail you need to make an informed decision. You know, big events like the Dew Tour, I think it stands to reason that you should pull those off the consent agenda and present them, you know, for the public's information. But we'll schedule them like this, and there'll be times where the consent agenda will be approved under one motion, and there'll be times where it won't. So I think you saw tonight the legislative process work the way that we intended it to during our discussions. So just wanted to make that observation and comment.
Thank you, David. Light lights on here. Comments from the mayor and city council. Start with Margaret.
Yes, I have to back up to item number 10E. I meant to make a comment, didn't get called on, so I waited till time for the council to speak. And but it's about the harassment of a free workplace policy. I think the viewing audience would like to understand why we're putting that in place. It was something that we knew should be in the policy, and we just put it in there. So if you just give an explanation, I'd appreciate it.
Yes, ma'am. This is a code of conduct that we initiated to identify the expectations of our employees. It talks about the behavior that is acceptable, and specifically the type of behavior that is unacceptable as it relates to protected class and protected characteristic. By adopting the code of conduct by resolution, we've included it in the employee handbook, which the harassment-free workplace policy is part of. And it will apply organization-wide.
Mm. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Knight.
Yes, I just wanted to report that I attended the Chapter 1917 AARP meeting last Thursday. They make an exception and they let me come, even though I'm very youthful, because I'm so youthful. Anyway, just to give them a little bit of, give you all a little bit of information about them, they meet the second Thursday of the month at 9:30. There's a social half hour. Then at 10 o'clock is the meeting, 10 to 11. The meeting place is the Knights of Columbus at 99th Street. There's always a speaker, and there's always, it's a diverse group of people. In April, they're going to have Delmarva Discovery. The mayor has spoken before. Jim Mathias is going to speak in May. If you would like to join, and it's extremely reasonable, you have to be a member of the National AARP. But then their annual dues are only $7 a year. You get to enjoy other folks' company. You get great travel deals. You can go to AARP1917.org, or we're lucky enough, every week, the president comes to our meetings. His name is Chris Norris, and you can call him on 302-436-1784. So I just wanted to get that information out. Thank you.
Thank you, Mary. All right. Councilmember Ashley.
Mr. President, I have two quick items. Number one, I just did a handout to the mayor and council.
It's not on.
Another one?
Mm-hmm. Speaker, no,
you're hitting the wrong button.
All one?
Now you are.
One now? Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you. I just did a handout to the mayor and council. I just want to say, as a student of government, as well as a fun guy, as the mayor said, I frequently visit the websites of other municipalities to see how they conduct council meetings. Several times since I've been on the council, I've had citizens ask me how they could have items placed on the council agenda for discussion. I've always told them to call the council president. However, during a recent visit to the website at Cocoa Beach, Florida, I noticed that they make available to their citizens an agenda item request form, which creates an official record of their request. I thought this was a smart idea and a great way to keep the citizens involved in government. I'd like to request
the use of the agenda request item be put on a agenda in the near future for discussion.
All right.
Okay, I think it's an excellent way to keep the citizens involved.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, and I have one other quick item. We're talking about the
Germany View magazine.
The tourism reaches. I would just like to say, offer, what was that? We good?
Yeah, it was a chair.
Oh, okay. I thought somebody fell over.
No.
No. I'm sorry.
Don't panic yet, Mary. Okay?
No.
Okay.
Sorry.
I'd just like to offer kudos to one of our landmark boardwalk businesses that is featured this month in a major German and European magazine called View with a two-page picture and article.
That'd be cool.
Joe Kroer has been passionately promoting Ocean City for over 50 years to anyone that would listen. Joe started in Ocean City as a college student artist selling his pictures and photographs on the boardwalk, and I think it's safe to say that through the years he has become one of Ocean City's true treasures. The Ocean Gallery has been featured in many publications, movies, television, news shows here in the country, and now Joe and the Ocean Gallery has taken Ocean City global. So I just wanted to thank Joe.
That's great.
And show you all full page layout. So I know we're talking about Pittsburgh, but I think this gets out there pretty
much. That's a bike rider.
Yep.
Ride a bike.
So thank you.
All right. Thank you. Councilmember Simak.
Mr. President, I'd like to make a motion that we go to closed session to discuss some contractual matters we have to.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yep. David has an issue. All right.
Second.
Councilmember Matresik.
Second.
All right.
You. I'll wait for the end.
Okay. I have a motion by Councilmember Simak and a second by Councilmember Matresik to go to closed session for legal and contractual matters. I think we have one item. I think that David was going to bring it up.
Would you please explain to me what this item is?
Yes, ma'am. It's a follow-up contractual item from a previous council meeting that we have some additional detail on.
Is this about union contracts?
No, ma'am.
No,
it's
no.
Regarding advertising.
Advertising.
I have a motion and a second to go to a closed session. All those in favor? Vote is 7 in favor. We're going to go to a closed session.
No, you're not.
No. All right. Mr. Mayor.
He's going to gavel me.
All right. Yep.
A couple things. First, yes, those comments were a jest, as we have kidded about how that consent agenda might be a little bit bumpy along the way.
And
What you might see is that some of those really big items, like the Dew Tour, you might not put on the consent, just because you know there's going to be discussion. But I think it's appropriate to try to do what we can to streamline the agenda, and Mr. Recor's ideas are very well accepted. Just want to make a few comments. First, if you all didn't know, Saturday was the St. Patrick's Day Parade in Ocean City, and we drew a few people into town. Many of the people that I talk to tell me that it's their best weekend of the year. I'm not talking about the winner of the year. It was a great crowd, and I want to thank all the citizens and everybody that participated, the Delmarva Irish American Club for all their efforts, and for Buck Mann for organizing the parade, because that's all put on by a nonprofit volunteer organization, and it just shows you what a group can do when they get together and want to do something good for the community. And they raise money for various charities throughout the town. So great. And they said it was going to rain on the Irish. Can you believe they even tried to say that? A couple other things. I'll be going to Annapolis tomorrow. Went last Tuesday to testify tomorrow before the House with regard to the bill that's in the House. It was in the Senate last week to study starting the school days after Labor Day. There was a bill submitted by Delegate Mathias. John Astle from Annapolis is also part of that. We testified before the Senate last week. I went up along with Councilman Dare, Donna Abbott, and then representatives of the Chamber of Commerce were there as well, and the Hotel Motel Restaurant Association, and Greg Shockley from the state. So we're going to do the same thing tomorrow. We're also going to be testifying tomorrow on another bill in the House Ways and Means Committee, I believe, and this is a bill that has to do with recycling. There was a bill passed last year that would require all multifamily buildings of over 10 units, I think, to have recycling receptacles. I thought that we had gotten Ocean City exempted from that bill. That's what I thought. But I looked at the bill again this year and realized that was not the case. So because we have a waste-to-energy program and we do not do recycling in the traditional manner but do it through the waste-to-energy program, we're going to go up and we're going to testify to get Ocean City exempted. And we have the support of the Delmarva Condominium Managers Association as well, because that would create a tremendous burden for those buildings. So we're going to go up there and do that. That's where we'll be tomorrow. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. And even
Mayor.
Yes.
So,
oh, got a vote. You know, I do mention these things occasionally, and it's tough whenever we lose one of our Ocean City area residents. But we did lose a very important resident on Sunday.
Sunday morning.
Sunday?
Yes.
Sunday morning.
Sunday morning, Mitch Scott. And Mitch Scott, of course, from Scott Broadcasting, and he's been in Ocean City in a radio business in a surrounding area for years. And Mitch is one of those that gave a lot more to others than he ever gave to himself, and was always active in fundraisers and played Santa Claus. And you needed somebody to make a contribution to something, it was Mitch Scott. You needed somebody to pull something together, to organize something, to benefit somebody else, it was Mitch Scott. And it's really a shame that we did lose him, unfortunately, on Sunday. And we just want to send our thoughts and prayers out to his family and to all his friends, of which there are very many throughout the Ocean City area. Thank you, Councilman
Sinek.
All
right. Thank you. All right. We're going to go to closed session, and we'll be back, and we'll return and close the meeting. Thank you. We'll be right back.